The road to greatness is not marked by perfection, but by the ability to constantly overcome adversity and failure to get better. So never give up and never give in. I am Ben Meiniger, and I am ready for the new season.
The only factor that we can control is work ethic. It doesn't matter what anyone else does around you, any variable that you can't control, it doesn't matter, because the one thing you can control is how hard you work.
Fourth and seven for Stanford. Stands in there, fires to the corner, the end of the Buren, touchdown! Justin Buren with a huge touchdown for the Clan!
It's a fake.
And oh, it's intercepted! It's intercepted, Clan football! Go to the other side of the field as a decoy, and they are gonna get a touchdown in the far corner of the end zone. On there, that's gonna be picked off! That's going to be picked off by the Clan down the sideline and knocked out of bounds. Ben Meiniger, the Surrey native. Pressure coming though, and that will be a sack in the backfield by the Clan. Braxton, he's going to lose the football, and the Clan are going to fall on that ball and get at the Clan at their own 16-yard line.
Replay here for Simon Fraser.
And they will make a great catch to Buren! That's Justin Buren, the 30, the 20, the 10! Buren is going to find the end zone! Touchdown, Simon Fraser! The handoff is going to go to Leitre. He makes a great cut, Leitre, to the end zone, Ante Leitre! With the touchdown for Simon Fraser! Good evening, everybody. Welcome to Swangard Stadium in Burnaby, British Columbia, Canada. It's the start of another GNAC football season here with the Simon Fraser Clan. I'm Howard Samura, your play-by-play voice, joined again by my analyst, Nick Sirski. Nick, it's going to be an interesting year for the Simon Fraser Clan football team. The preseason's been tough, but there's a lot of positives they're going to have to try and build on.
Exactly, and we're at the start of the GNAC portion of the season, and these are when the games really matter. Have had a rough start, but you've played a Div 1 team and also a team from the Lone Star Conference that is pretty strong this season. So the Clan will have to regroup from those two losses, but moving ahead, looking forward to a team that they know, a team in Humboldt State that unfortunately didn't play too well against last year in their only game against them last year. But looking forward to this season and doing play-by-play again with you this year.
It's going to be fun, Nick. 57-0 was the score last season when the Clan headed to Humboldt State. They've got them here this season. It's obviously an incredibly tough test for Kelly Bates' club. You mentioned Texas A&M Kingsville, the team that they lost to last week. That team had beaten Incarnate Word, a Division I FCS team. That is a very, very tough preseason schedule that Coach Bates has. Idaho State to open. What are the positives from taking, the big losses against tough opponents over the first 2 weeks?
And I think you're just trying to learn. And early in the season, you want to focus on execution and focus on not turning the ball over, which they had a couple inconsistencies the last couple games. They had a great start against Idaho State, stayed in that game until midway through maybe the second quarter. Things did not go so well against Texas A&M last weekend, and they were down about 40-0 after the first quarter. So just trying to build on the positives, build on ball control, keeping new quarterback Miles Richardson, keeping him standing up straight, throwing lasers and being efficient in the passing game, and talking about our running game, using those big boys up front to push them around.
We'll get to a couple of the players in just a second here. We should let the viewers know 47-3 was the loss in Pocatello, Idaho to Idaho State to start the season, and then last week, as Nick says, 68-7, the loss to Texas A&M Kingsville. The Javelinas, as Nick mentioned, 40 points in the opening quarter in that game to make it a moot point pretty much from the first quarter onwards. You mentioned Miles Richardson. Let's talk about him. Hard luck kid. He was a backup under Vernon Adams at Eastern Washington. He went to Pima Junior College. I believe he broke his foot in the first game of the year. He hadn't thrown a lot of passes until he got up top of Burnaby Mountain.
Exactly, and this is a kid who prides himself on being efficient, watching practice. He can move, he can run, and he can throw accurately on the run. Unfortunately, I think his completion percentage coming into this game hovers around 40%. You're going to want to see that to up to about 60, 65% to just be competitive in this game. But I think he can do that, and moving the pocket is, I think, something that we're going to see from this Klan football team
today.
Well,
we were the next player on the list to talk about here is Ante Leitra, the running back out of Notre Dame secondary, who had a breakthrough season, I'm sure you'll agree, last season, Nick, but some injury issues. We don't know. We understand he's dressing. I don't know how much he's going to play. We might see a bit of Jalen Janna, the transfer who's come in now as the backup running back, but how do you address the issues of that running game? Negative yardage, the whole push from that offensive line.
And anybody's in there has just got to, you know, keep working hard, keep executing, because like you mentioned, they had negative rushing yards over the past two games, and that's something that you can't control the ball if you're not going to be able to run the ball, and, or sorry, control the clock if you're not going to be able to run the ball. So that's something that Coach Bates assessed in this past week, and I'm sure they're going to try this run game against a quick and athletic Humboldt team. They're going to have to find the creases and hit the holes hard to get some positive yardage to keep Humboldt honest.
How much, I don't know if pressure is the right word, Nick, but let me just throw these names at you. Gakasan at the left tackle, Beck at the left guard, and Telford at center. For those guys along that offensive line, they have a bit of experience here, not a lot of depth, so they're really going to have to be on their game.
They are, and you know, Howie, like I mentioned, those are guys that are coming back this season as starters. You know, they left Couture to the Blue Bombers in the CFL. You know, that's a big loss on that left side. So they're just going to have to focus on the fundamentals. And, you know, clearly they haven't had great success on the ground, but going to have to push through that, because against this Humboldt team who can score quick and put up points in a hurry, they're going to have to control the clock and run that clock down and keep this game close and low scoring as long as possible.
Interesting. Kelly Bates with his BC Lions ties obviously brings in Joe Pau-Pau, throwing Samoan as his offensive coordinator. Interesting to note that Dean Valley's the offensive line coach, a ton of time in the CFL, a real veteran. I mean, that's the kind of coach you need to be working with these guys.
And you think that that'll only help these guys moving forward in the season, and then helping Kelly Bates recruit other, you know, offensive linemen who may want to go to the CFL. I think SFU can be that harbor for great offensive linemen, you know, moving forward into the CFL. We see Matthias Goosen with the Bombers and Michael Couture with the Bombers as well. So I think we should be able to become a good O-line factory, if you will, with Kelly Bates and Dean Valley on this coaching staff.
Let's move to the other side of the football. The CFL draft rankings came out. I don't know if you looked at them on Wednesday or Thursday. The first thing I did when they came out was I looked for the Herdmans on the list. Yep. Neither of them was listed. Jordan Herdman, I was surprised by that. I got to tell you that they weren't on that list. I think they're going to be incredible next level players. But just talk a bit about Jordan Herdman. We talk a ton about this kid, but he's the heart and soul of that defense at the middle linebackers.
Well, he's the guts, and he's going to have to be flying around the field today. You know, with Jaquan in the backfield for the Jacks, they're going to have to keep him contained and you know, shut them down on defense.
We're going to throw to the anthems here on Klan TV and be back after this.
Thank you.
And welcome back, everybody, to Swangard Stadium. Howard Samura, Nick Sirski, minutes away from the start of the kickoff of the 2016 GNAC football season here at Swangard Stadium. Let's jump quickly into that Humboldt State offense. And we, you know, obviously are going to be calling his name all night. He wears number 32, Jaquan Gardner, already with 300 yards rushing in his first two games. This is a guy that the Klan are going to be facing that is going to be extremely tough to stop.
Yeah, I mean, he leads their rushing game and he leads their passing game too. He's tied for lead in receptions and receiving yardage. Averages all-purpose yards, 200 a game. So they're going to have to focus on him, focus on shutting him down as much as possible and allowing Humboldt to beat them some way else other than Jaquan there in the backfield.
Watching him play against Azusa Pacific, just such a quality running back. 2,266 yards rushing last year, led all of Division II football. Interesting, his rushing totals were almost the same as the passing numbers of quarterback Robert Weber, who is back, a 5'9" quarterback, Nick. A compact guy, but a guy who can get things done, and he's got a nice receiver as well in Trace Krivoshe.
Yep, and these are going to be efficient guys. They've had a good start to the season here, and also returning two big offensive linemen, Alex Kappa and Lucas Govan, who are going to anchor that run game and make sure that Gardner, you know, gets those holes and can rush for big yards. For SFU, the key is obviously going to be the defense and the Herdman twins in the linebacking core. Really closing the defensive line's got to close down those gaps, and the Herdmans have got to rally to the ball carrier and bring them down for a little to no gain, and don't let them break any tackles.
It is Govan, number 54. Nick mentioned the center as well. The left tackle is Kappa, the redshirt junior, wearing number 71, and they will play a key role for Humboldt State. They're getting the festivities underway here at midfield.
SFU is going to receive, I believe, on our going from left to right for the first drive.
So the Simon Fraser Clan set to receive in front of this nice crowd here today at Swangard Stadium. Nick, the early forecast was for rain. I got here about 2 or 3 hours before game time. It was a monsoon here. Talk about the field conditions right now and the weather as it's turned.
You know, it's going to be wet down there, but I know Swangard Stadium field. It has great drainage. I think it'll be fine. I think the players will be just fine. Might be a little bit slippery to start the game, but as this sun hits the field, it'll dry it out, and I don't think the field conditions will be any issue moving forward in this game.
Well, the teams are getting ready now to take to the field. It's the moment we've all been waiting for. Kelly Bates, the head coach, in his second year with the Simon Fraser Football Clan, of course, winless last season, and the Clan facing a couple of tough teams in Texas A&M, Kingsville, and Idaho State in the preseason. This is where it all counts, and Simon Fraser now will get set to return this kick. Back there to receive is going to be Gavin Cobb, the pure freshman out of Mount Douglas Secondary School in Victoria, wearing number 11, as well as going to be number 32. That is David Legou. So those two back to receive the kick.
And Cobb kind of came out of nowhere early in this. He's a true freshman, so focusing on him in the passing game will be something that we'll look forward to today.
Cobb was the BC High School AAA Football Player of the Year, but steps in as a freshman, and Cobb is set to return this ball. He's going to take it at his 2, and Gavin Cobb over the 10 makes a nice move, gets to the 15, but he's going to be brought down there by number 28, Nick Julier, a defensive back out of Thousand Oaks, California, making the tackle there, Nick, and Klan going to be starting inside their 20 here.
Here comes Richardson. Again, we mentioned the transfer. He's going to have to focus on not turning the ball over. There we see some of the stats from early in the season, that 40% completion percentage I mentioned is going to have to come up to above 60 if they want to be in this game. No offensive touchdowns, as we mentioned in the pregame. That's something that they're going to have to work on, obviously, if they want to be in this game.
So here we go, getting set to open the season offense for the Klan, single back, and a quick pass now to Cobb, and he's going to catch the ball over the 20 out about the 22-yard line. So getting a bit of a feel, nice short pass to start the game. Good move there.
Yep, and a nice little quick out by Cobb. Get the ball in his hands early. He is an explosive playmaker, so getting the ball into his hands and seeing what he can do. Gain of about 6 yards, which is anything more than 4 on first down is amazing.
The offense has struggled, to put it lightly, the last 2 weeks for the Simon Fraser Clan. Call this 2nd and 4 from their own 23-yard line. Looks like Legou in the backfield there. Well, check that, Jalen Janna, number 10, the transfer. scrambling back there and looking for a man. He's going to keep the ball and get taken down behind the line of scrimmage. So the Humboldt State defense active and causing all kinds of problems in the Klan backfield on that play.
Yeah, and that's tough. That was almost a coverage sack, Howie. The coverage was pretty good downfield, but that's something that we'll see from Richardson. He can scramble, and if he can break a tackle, he can go for a big gain. So that's something to key on as we move ahead in this game.
Loss of a yard in a bit. Third and seven now from about the, what do you want to call that, the 18-yard line? Richardson set to take the snap. Looks down the field. Oh, incomplete. Had a man there trying to find.
Flag on the play, though, Howie. Late one.
Looking for J.J. Delorier on that play. A flag on the field, as Nick says. We'll see what happens here.
I think it looks like it's going to be pass interference, Howie. That's a big break for the Klan.
Well, a nice route run there by Delorier, the St. Thomas More product, and he's clapping his hands as he comes back to the Simon Fraser huddle.
And so there we see that nice strong arm from Richardson. You know, he can do it with his arm and he can do it with his legs. So, nice route by Delorier. Had a couple options on that play, Richardson did. And, here we see the replay. See if we can pick it up. He just runs a nice post route and probably just grabbed his arm there right at the end, trying to prevent that big play, the Humboldt corner there, and taking the 10-yard penalty and an automatic first down.
So first and 10, Klan at their own 34-yard line. High snap by Richardson, hands it off, and Jana pushing forward, some good yardage there. So again on first down, the Klan finding some success, about a four-yard pickup there, Nick.
Hey, and we're getting positive yards on the in the rushing game, and that's something that I think Kelly Bates wanted to key on this week in practice. You know, getting 4 yards on first down, making it more second and manageable, not having that second and 10 or second and 12, worse yet, is something that will keep these drives moving and keep Richardson comfortable in the pocket. Again, four wide.
Jan in the backfield, and Richardson now. Quick pass, quickly to Cobb, is going to get buried there. Making the tackle there was number 9 of Humboldt State.
Yep, and a just nice way to rally up to the ball there by Humboldt. There wasn't much there. Just a quick pass, trying to get the ball to Cobb, and maybe make that first tackle miss, get yardage for the first down. But again, third and 5, quite manageable here, Howie.
Nash with a tackle there, number 9 for Humboldt State. So the Klan now third and about 6 here from their own 39-yard line. Richardson waiting the snap here. Again, here he comes. He is getting chased back there, and Richardson running hard for that first down marker, and he's going to get it. Great job there, as you mentioned, Nick. Great scrambling ability by Richardson.
And Humboldt brought some pressure there, Howie, but they didn't quite have that right end blocked off, and Richardson was able just to tuck and run real quick. Good recognition by him. Didn't hesitate, tucked that ball away and ran, and was able to pick up their second first down of this drive. A good positive yardage here early.
So up to the 45-yard line, the Simon Fraser 45. It's going to be first down for Simon Fraser. Trying to extend the drive here in their opening possession of the GNAC campaign here from Swangard Stadium. Jalen Janna, the lone back in the backfield. Richardson, another quick throw on the sidelines. Has a man, and that looks like Buren on the far sideline.
And Howie, early, they're just spreading Humboldt out, going four wide here with a single back in the backfield in Jana, and just quick passes, making Humboldt make tackles, but getting 7 yards on first down a stud that really came out last year in Justin Buren.
Yeah, Justin Buren, the Centennial Centaurs product, great season last year and a tough year, but a breakthrough season for him, number 15. This time he'll line up on the far side of the field. There is a snap, and Jana moved there, but he's not going to get anywhere. The tackle there is going to be made by number 47, and that's Josh Hinson, the defensive lineman, a junior out of Fresno, California, making the stop there.
And good penetration by Humboldt there. Hinson got into the backfield, able to make contact with the running back, a couple yards behind the line of scrimmage, and Humboldt rallies up to make this tackle. Just about at midfield here, third and seven.
Clan wanting to convert again on third down. Penalty aided on one drive and a nice nice play the last time for third down to get that, keep the drive going. Here they go again, third and seven. Richardson looking down the field on the near side of the field. Has Delorier batted away at the last second there by number 27, Davian Johnson. A great play from the secondary of the Humboldt State Jacks.
Yeah, and just a good play. Delorier runs a nice corner route there.
Really Howie, does.
You can see this on the replay here. Had him beat, but nice play there by the Humboldt defensive back, knocking that away at the last second, forcing a punt for the Clan.
So the Clan are going to have to punt it away here on fourth down. Looks like Sage Burmeister back there to a return. So Simon Fraser now getting its chance. What can its defense do here? This Humboldt State team, as we mentioned, it was a big one last year, 57-0. So
yeah, and just wanting to limit those explosion plays, tackling Gardner and rallying up to Gardner. We hear Krebischai may not play tonight. He's a little banged up, so that's a positive for the Clan, obviously, but Jaquan Gardner is going to be their first worry that they're going to have to deal with tonight.
Number 32 is in the backfield here for quarterback Robert Weber on first down from their own 12-yard line. First offensive possession of the game for Humboldt State. It's a handoff to Gardner, and he's going to power his way, and Gardner is breaking right through the line, and nobody is going to stop Jaquan Gardner. That is an 88-yard touchdown run on the first play from scrimmage for Jaquan Gardner.
And there you go. We see how dangerous he can be. Howie Gardner takes that, and I think he was basically untouched to the end zone. Little option there by the quarterback to hand it off. And Gardner busts a big one and takes it all the way for six.
It looked like a men against boys there scenario. He just blew through the line. And, boy, I don't know if you are ever sure about a touchdown that early on a running play, but literally 10 strides into that run, you knew nobody was going to stop Jaquan Gardner.
Well, and Humboldt pulling a page from the Clan playbook, having four wide receivers there and then just Gardner up against probably a six-man box. And Gardner just breaks that first tackle and on his way for a touchdown.
Well, it Simon Fraser behind the eight ball early. And
here we can see the replay. Howie, six-man box, and he's just untouched.
Broke free there. And Gardner, as we mentioned last season, 2,226 yards in 2015, and he gets 88 of the easiest yards he's going to get this season on that first play.
Already halfway to his all-purpose average right there with 88 yards on that first carry. So, again, Klein will have to shake that off. That's a tough first play, first drive, but shake it off. You did some really great things here on offense to start the game. Get back to those fundamentals and stay in this game.
Gardner now with six rushing touchdowns on the season. Came in with 297 yards and five TDs on 56 carries. Humboldt State now set to kick to the Simon Fraser Clan, and Cobb again back to receive along with Lagoon number 32, Cobb number 11. Cameron Southward number 45 set to kick off to the Clan. Early in this opening quarter play already, 7-0 for Humboldt State. Cobb's going to take it just inside his goal line, take a knee there for the touchback. .955 here remaining in the opening quarter of play. Simon Fraser's second possession of the game. And Nick, we saw some nice things on first down. We saw some, you know, a couple of third down conversions on that drive. It broke and really breaks your back when they're able to just have one play and score a massive touchdown.
We're
like
winning
that.
The time of possession battle, though, Howie. We've got to think of the positives here. But, no, some great stuff from the Clan on this first drive or on that first drive. They're just going to have to keep focusing on that, and defense is going to have to rally up and make those tackles for Gardner, because I don't think that's the last time we're going to call Gardner's name. He's going to be running the ball wild all over the field tonight.
Three receivers here. A flag goes up. They went to Tom Franklin, the South Delta product, number 87 on the far side of the field, but they'll march that back. Penalty called against Simon Fraser. It's going to make it first and 15 from the 20. In that wide receiver group, it's DeLaurier wearing number 13. We saw Franklin, 87. He brings some size. Buren lining up along with, looks like Cobb at the near side of the field here. Hand off to Janna, looking up the middle and finds nothing. In fact, Janna's going to probably lose a yard on that play.
Yeah, just trying to, again, spread them out and bring a tight end in as an extra blocker. Trying to get that to bring... pulling Gakusana there, but unable to get much there and stop for no gain.
There's no easy ones in the GNAC, but Simon Fraser clearly getting a very tough start to the season. We talked about their two preseason opponents. This Humboldt State team dropped in the rankings after their loss to Azusa Pacific last week, but still a top 25 team nationally in D2.
Exactly. So don't forget they were ranked, and you know they lost to Azusa Pacific, who Azusa Pacific moved up to the 24th in the nation this week. So this is a good team that they're playing tonight. And they're going to have to bring their A game.
Richardson looks downfield. Buren looking as the intended receiver there. Turned a little too late, and it just wasn't a lot of crispness in that pass from Richardson to Buren. So it's going to bring up third down now, and a big play here for Simon Fraser if they want to start to establish an offensive identity in this football game. Cobb and Buren line up to the near side of the field. Richardson is going to take the sack back about his 8-yard line.
It looked like they were trying to set up a screen there, Howie, but Humboldt was able to rally up to the running back and cover him up. Richardson doing the smart thing there, just tucking the ball. Yeah, we can see there Janna in the backfield tries to sneak out, but Richardson not able to get the ball, and that'll take a sack there.
So Simon Fraser unable to get anything going on that last drive. We're going to have to kick the ball away. They'll be punting out of their own end zone here early in the first quarter of play. Being fielded at about the 43-yard line there by
number six.
That was Dylan Zuvrink.
You got two number sixes on their roster. That's why I'm confused.
I believe that was Zuvrink, though. He's their one of their top guys, and that is a great bit of field position here for Humboldt State, who've only run one play on offense and already lead 7-0.
And anytime you can start a drive inside the opponent's territory, and this time not even on a turnover, but SFU's going to have to, you know, clamp down on defense and hopefully force three and out here, or if we can get field goal attempt, that'd be positive for this drive.
So Weber taking the snap here from the Simon Fraser 43-yard line. Another hand off to Gardner. That time Simon Fraser able to find the ball and avert disaster.
Guess who's at the bottom of the pile there, Howie? 57, Jordan Herdman.
Jordan Herdman.
We're going to be saying that name a lot on defense, too, and I think that's the matchup. It's going to be Herdman against Gardner. You know, he's going to have to wrap him up and bring him down as quickly as possible.
Well, he's got those spy glasses out from the middle linebacker spot, and again, Gardner's going to take the ball. Quick moves to try and gain some yardage here, but he's going to get back to the original line of scrimmage and no more. So two good plays back-to-back there. Of course, about a third and seven here for Humboldt State.
And good,
Simon Fraser, 41.
Good penetration by that defensive line and rallying up and tackling Gardner. That's what they're going to have to do all night long.
Four receiver set here for the Lumberjacks. Weber with Gardner in the backfield. Gardner in motion. He's going to take a pass here. Break through one tackle. Skip another. Still on his feet, but he's not.
About 4 yards, 3 yards short of the first down there, Howie.
So
maybe
Simon
two.
Fraser able to
early decision. Early decision here for Humboldt, though. It looks like their offense is staying on the field in this fourth down situation. And this would be a big stop for the Klan if they could get this one.
Humboldt State Fourth and two from the 35-yard line of the Simon Fraser clan. And we know who's getting the ball here as Weber takes the snap. Ooh, flags are going to fly here. And that ball was snapped, but it just shot along the ground to Gardner's ankles. See what the officials have to say here.
Offside against the clan, Howie, and that's a real tough one on fourth down, gifting them that first down. And it looked like that's what they were trying to do, get that hard count and get the clan to move, and that's exactly what they did.
So Humboldt State moves up to first and 10 at the clan 30. We've got more whistles, more flags as Gardner went in motion to the near side of the field. So the penalty going against Humboldt this time. So that'll make it first and 15 now for Humboldt State from the 35. The handoff to Gardner up the middle, dancing, but again, the clan doing a good job to limit him to a gain of about 5 yards.
Gets him back to about that original line of scrimmage, and Humboldt looking like they're going with a bit of tempo offense here, Howie. Not huddling, just looking to the sideline, getting that play call. And running, they ran that play with about 20 seconds on the play clock left of the 40-second play clock. So they're running here and trying to tire out this clan defense.
Well, they'll test the depth of that clan defense for sure. Great point, Nick, as they get set here on second and 10. There's the handoff, the fake, and Weber. Little pass there on the far sideline, and they're going to get inside the 15-yard line. And that looks like it was the tight end, Dylan Little's making a nice catch on the far sideline.
And that's how that's what you can afford when you have a good pass or a good running game. You can fake that handoff and leak the tight end out the backside. Picks up an easy 15 yards on the first down.
So first and 10 now at the 15 of the Simon Fraser clan. Marching are the Humboldt State Lumberjacks. Already with one touchdown on the board, but won a two-score lead here. Weber, the quick handoff to Gardner. Oh, he fakes it to Gardner. They go across the field, and a nice tackle made there by the Simon Fraser clan.
That's Pugh stepping up, making a big tackle, but a late flag here, Howie. Wonder if somebody said something after the play.
Jordan Pugh, one of the veterans of that Simon Fraser defensive secondary.
Yeah,
well, I think they called it against Pugh.
And I think it looked like a taunting penalty. Probably said something there. And that's the last thing you want to do after you make a big play. Just get up, dust yourself off, make your way back to the huddle. Don't be chirping the other team and gifting them a first down and a first and goal inside your own 10-yard line. That's a tough break.
You've used the word gifting twice on this drive, Nick. And Pugh, a tough break there. The free safety getting called for the penalty. First and goal now from the 9-yard line. Gardner lined up in the backfield with Weber. He'll take a pitch and come to the near side of the field. Eyes on the goal line, and he goes into the end zone for the touchdown. Jaquan Gardner with a 9-yard touchdown run, his second of the game.
Yeah, and it just looked like the clan were just outflanked there, Howie. I was looking at that formation, a little bit interested to see why the corner was so far off that wide receiver, but they've just quick pitch to Jaquan Gardner and scampers in for his second touchdown of the game.
And you talked about tempo as well, Nick, with this Humboldt State offense, and it's no surprise Simon Fraser doesn't have the deepest team in the world here. We'll see if that tempo continues to be a factor as they add the extra point and go up 14-0. 4:52 here remaining in this first quarter of play. We'll take a short break and be back with more on Clan TV.
If I lose, I'll respond with respect.
If I win, I'll back it up with humility.
If I fail, I'll rise up with honor. It's tough for us to put it all on the line.
Don't undo my hard work with poor sportsmanship.
Respect. It's the name of the game.
Howard Samura, Nick Sirski back at Swangard Stadium. It's 14-0 for Humboldt State. We're in the GNAC opener here at Swangard Stadium. 4:52 remaining in the first quarter of play. The big touchdown run by Gardner to start the game, Nick. Now a 43-yard drive, some good field position, and they cash it in at the end.
And two penalties that gave the Humboldt Jacks two first downs, and that's a killer, and you can't take that against one of the top teams in the country, let alone your conference. Kleiner got to learn from that to rally up on this drive and put something positive together here is, you know, trying to keep this game close here in the first quarter.
Lumberjacks set to kick off from their own 35. Cobb in the end zone will take a knee, and the Clan will start their third possession of this game at the 25-yard line. The importance of Richardson testing this defense, using his arm. They went up the middle with Delorier on that first drive. They drew a penalty, made some good things happen. They've got to stay aggressive.
Exactly. Stay aggressive and try and control this clock a little bit more. Taking some shots deep looks like what the game plan is tonight, and I'm okay with that. You know, you're already down 14 points, so you're going to have to take some shots down the field. But keep in mind, you know, that running game and getting Jana the ball as well. Keeping Humboldt off balance is what's going to be successful here in this game.
Tom Franklin, Andrew Paul's in this game, bringing some size to that receiving core as Jana lines up in the backfield with Richardson. The play action fake there, and Richardson over the middle again for Delorier, and it overthrows him. Very similar to that opening drive, Nick. This time, no penalty by Humboldt.
Yeah, and throwing it to double coverage there, Howie. I thought he had 87 there over the middle. Franklin there on the post route earlier, but decides to throw the deeper corner, and unfortunately just out of his reach. And not able to make that completion.
So second and 10 from the 25. C.J. Smith and Davian Johnson with the coverage on that last play. As we talked about that aggressiveness in Richardson, we saw it right there off that snap. This time it's going to be a handoff to Jan. A nice cut, but he's going to hit the wall at the line of scrimmage. So right now, two plays, now third down again. Third and basically 10 here from the 25.
And this is what you want to avoid, Howie, is third and long. This is going to be a tough conversion for the Clan. But, you know, third and 10, drop a good play. Make sure as a receiver, get to that first down marker. If you're running a comeback route, get to 11 yards. And then when you fall back, it's 10. And, you know, keep that ball out of Humboldt's hands here in this first quarter.
Tough, tough weeks for Simon Fraser to open the season, finding themselves down early, especially last week against A&M Kingsville. This week down 14-0. And here they go on third down. Richardson forced a scramble. He looks downfield. He's got a man. Can't find Buren, who was turning like a top there under coverage from Arian Nash.
Yeah, and Richardson kind of running for his life back there. Some good pressure by the Jacks. Brought some guys, brought some heat. Man coverage down the field, just trying to toss it up and get to one of our skilled players in Buren. But couldn't make the completion there. Just an injury note, Howie. You see Delorier limped off the field after that last play. We'll have to keep an eye on his situation there. Physical trainer there, or physio trainer, Al Best there, taking a look at him on the sidelines.
Well, they're already thin at so many spots. As we mentioned, Ante Litra, their top running back, not playing in this game due to injury. Jan has been taking the handoffs in the backfield. And Delorier's been a chief target here for Miles Richardson early in this game. So now the Lumberjacks again with good field position. Going to start from their own 41-yard line.
Going to limit the penalties here on this drive, Howie. Again, I think two of the four first downs on the last drive were given by penalty. Really going to have to avoid those against a top team in the nation.
It looks like they've got Blair Zaire in there at running back. So a different running back in there, and he's going to play action here from Weber. He's going to go down the field. He's got a man through his hands. Can't make the catch there.
Flag on the field. Benedino in coverage, and I thought he was actually with him. He was with him, Howie, and I thought he had good positioning, but he did seem to tug that shoulder pad. Not sure if we can get a look here on the replay. But
Zuvarink was the receiver, we believe, number six.
and just kind of tugs him there at the end, and that's going to be a 10-yard penalty and an automatic first down.
So Humboldt State to move over into Simon Fraser territory now. This is their third possession of the game, their third drive. They've scored on their first two. And they're going to be first and 10 from the Klan 44-yard line. Weber, the 5'9 quarterback, the handoff up the middle. Great run right up the middle there. And that is Zaire, number 36.
Here on the replay, Howie again, just a little hand up off, up the middle. Klan trying to rally up, but still gave up about 6 yards on that first down carry. And again, Humboldt running tempo here, back up to the line of scrimmage.
First and 10, or rather second down at the Klan 37, second and about four. Hand off goes to Zaire, who stays in the game, and he's got enough for the first down, Nick. They're going to keep the chains moving.
And it looks like that's what they're going to do tonight, Howie, is pound that ball inside, take advantage of their big O-line and those returning All-Americans, and just run that ball down the throat of the Klan. So really got to stay steady and make some big tackles here.
Such an experienced group up front. They are sizably at an advantage there. Pass to the far sideline. Sage Burmeister made the catch as he went to the ground, the junior from La Jolla, California. So just shy of the first down, call it about second and 2.5 from about the 25-yard line of the Klan. Zaire again with the handoff. This time, Simon Fraser able to get to the football.
Gadyev on the tackle there in the backfield, and that's a good way to rally up and make those tackles in the backfield. Hopefully they can force a field goal attempt here on third and short.
It's a third down now for Humboldt State. There's a timeout on the field. We'll take one as well and be back with more on Klan TV.
One team.
400 athletes strong.
We sing not one,
but two national anthems.
We strive to always be better.
We put our heart into competition.
We pursue national championships and university degrees.
We care about our communities.
We are.
We are Canada's NCAA team.
Canada's NCAA team.
Canada's NCAA team.
We are Canada's NCAA team.
And welcome back, everybody, to Swangard Stadium. Howard Samura, Nick Sirski, Klan TV. First GNAC game of the season for the Simon Fraser Klan, and they want to stop this rolling thunder offense of the Humboldt State Lumberjacks, who are once again driving here on third down. Weber fakes the handoff to Zaire, rolls to his right, and is just going to get rid of the ball there. So the Simon Fraser Klan defense holds, Nick. A good sign for them early in this game.
Very well played there, Howie. The Jacks had a nice little levels route there where the quarterback had three options, and all of them were covered. So he's forced to throw the ball into the dirt, and he gets up limping.
So they went for it on fourth down at midfield.
Yeah, it looks like they're keeping that offense on the field again here, Howie, fourth and short.
So another big test here for the Klan on fourth down. Call it about fourth and two here. Weber the handoff to Zaire. He's going to cut up the middle, get the first down, head to the sidelines, and no one's going to stop him. Zaire with a touchdown, Humboldt State.
That was a nice run there by the Jacks. Pulled, I think, both their guards and did some nice cut blocks. Again,
we'll watch that on the replay here.
Yeah, pulled both their guards, couple cut blocks, and he's untouched into the end zone yet again.
So three possessions and three touchdowns here for Humboldt State. Big fourth down conversions on two of those drives. And now the Jacks looking to make it 21-0 here with the extra point. Snaps down southward with the kick, and it's good. 21-0 for Simon Fraser. 1:44 left in this opening quarter of play. We'll keep it right here with you. Simon Fraser, boy, Nick, I mean, you think back to last week, and it was 40-0 after the first quarter. I mean, you can say what you want. It's still a GNAC contest, and you're down by three scores early. It's got to be discouraging.
It's got to be discouraging, Howie, but the boys are going to have to keep their heads up. Obviously things have not gone the way they wanted, haven't really had the ball in Lumberjack territory yet this quarter. But they're going to have to get something positive going, because you can't just sit down and put your tail between your legs and quit. You still got three quarters to go, and you got to keep working hard.
Well, Gavin Cobb is back to receive this kickoff, and maybe special teams are the way for this team to rekindle some of that offensive energy. 1:44 left here in the opening quarter of play. Hope you're enjoying this GNAC football broadcast from Swangard Stadium. Our producer-engineer Gabe Lynn doing a great job here from the stadium. The nice sunny blue skies awaiting us here. Not too sunny for the Clan, though, as Cobb backs into his own end zone, and he's going to take a knee. And the Clan again will start at their own 25-yard line. Think about the receiving core of this Clan team, Nick, and you think about the way they've gone to Delorier. We'll see if he's still going to continue here, if he's going to be sitting in the center. We see Delorier actually on the sideline.
Got the helmet off. Doesn't look like he's coming in for this drive.
And noticeable limp, too, and that's a big, a tough break for the Clan. But a guy like Justin Buren, proven commodity in this league, and we know he's a game breaker. If they can find Buren, maybe they can get something going here on first down from the 25.
And we see Swerhorn in replacing Delorier on this close side at the wide receiver.
Pass out in the flat to Janna, puts on a bit of a fake and cuts up the sidelines. And nice job by Janna to get some extra yards at the end.
Yeah, perfect. And just a nice little swing pass there, Howie, trying to avoid that big pass rush that Humboldt's had, getting pressure on Richardson. Quick passes, quick release, getting the ball to the receivers in space, break a tackle, and get 7 yards.
Gain of seven, a second and three for the Simon Fraser Clan. They are at their own 32-yard line. Down to 1:21 left in the opening quarter of play. Janna in the backfield. Janna again trying to find some yardage there, but he is going to be stopped instantly. So Janna finding the real estate tough there on the near sideline as he runs into a swarm of Humboldt players. If you're just joining us, Ante Litra, the leading running back on this team last season, out due to injury, didn't practice this week, and that has really cut down things for the Clan, because they actually are getting some ability to run the ball here, and I think Litre would have been a nice tough runner against the Humboldt State.
He's a rumbling, tumbling man, and he can run downhill. That's a tough loss for the Clan this game.
So big third down call here. Third and three from the 32 of the Clan. Richardson looks downfield, goes to the sideline of Buren, but that ball is going to bounce off of his hands and go incomplete.
Nice coverage there by Nash, just stepping up right in front of the receiver, knocking it away. And unfortunately, the Clan go three and out here with just under 30 seconds left, 23 seconds left here in the first quarter. They're going to have to punt it away. And Humboldt will get that ball again here just in this first quarter.
Well, Nash has made a couple of nice plays in this game from his right cornerback spot for Humboldt State. So Zuvrink back to kick.
It's blocked.
It's
Howie.
Blocked. Humboldt State, they're going to fall on the football at about the 7-yard line. Wow.
And that was Francis that came right up the middle, Howie.
Huge, huge play on special teams by Humboldt State. Puts them right on the doorstep here. We still have 16 seconds remaining in the first quarter of play, but they are first and goal from the Clan 7-yard line.
And just came right up the middle, blocked that kick, and unable to scoop and score into the offense or into the end zone, but fell on it. And again, yeah, first and goal inside the Clan 10. Going to be a tough stop here for the Clan.
Boy, this is really asking a lot of this Clan defense. They've been on the field for so much of this opening quarter. They're going to go back to Gardner. RB1 is going to go to the far side, try and turn a corner, and can't quite get there. It's going to get taken down at about the 3-yard line.
And didn't look like there was much there, Howie, but he still was able to sneak around to tackle there and fall forward for 3 yards, getting down to about the 3-yard line, but that's going to bring us to the end of the first quarter.
And we'll take a break here and be back with the second quarter of play in Swangard Stadium on Clan TV.
It's on us to stop sexual violence.
We are Canada's NCAA team.
With 400 student athletes in 17 sports.
Together, we can end sexual violence at SFU.
To look out for each other.
And not look the other way.
To get a friend home safe.
To not blame the victim.
It's on us.
It's on us.
To speak up.
To step in.
To support those who need it.
To be a part of the solution, not the problem.
It's on me, it's on you, it's on us.
Because consent matters.
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 Learn more about how you can contribute to a culture of zero tolerance towards sexual violence at SFU by visiting sfu.ca/sexual assault.
Because together, we can make a difference.
Howard Samura, Nick Sirski back on Clan TV here at Swangard Stadium. We're set to start the second quarter of play. We will be talking about a lot of the nice initiatives happening at Swangard Stadium throughout the course of the evening. A great way to integrate minor football with the Simon Fraser Clan football team. But back on the field, not a pretty sight here right now as the Humboldt State Broncos perched on the doorstep of adding to this lead. They're going to go to Gardner right off the top, and Gardner looks to have gotten into the end zone. We'll wait for the signal from the officials.
And that's his third touchdown of the game, Howie. He falls forward there for 3 yards into the end zone and makes that score 27-0 here early in the second quarter.
So four possessions and four touchdowns. Of course, the last one coming off of a block, setting themselves up for the easiest touchdown they're going to score this season. 27-0 with the extra point pending. So 27-0. Simon Fraser unable to get much going here offensively. The extra point is good. And we're already starting to see some of the depth rotation here from this Humboldt State team, Nick. The last play before the end of the quarter had their second quarterback into the game. And that's Adam Wood. We'll see if that continues here. They've had Zarin as well as at running back in place of Gardner. So already starting to look to the depth on this roster.
Well, keep in mind, Howie, this team was played in the national playoff last year and won a game. So they're a good team. They're going to come. They come up to Burnaby here. Traditionally, haven't played too well up here. They've traditionally struggled, but clearly not struggling here. To start the game. Seconds old in the second quarter, and we're 28-0 down in the game.
If you're a Clan fan, I think your heart sank on that opening play from scrimmage. Oh, we're going to go to our sideline reporter, Aaron Martin, with a update, I think, on the status of receiver J.J. Laurie. Aaron, take it away.
Didn't look too serious, and JJ's set to come back into this game.
That's a big one, actually, Aaron. Thanks for that report, because JJ Delorier has been a good target here early on in this football game, Nick.
And already thin in the receiving corps, like you mentioned, Howie. Don't want to have one of your big seniors, a big playmaker, that drew that pass interference, gave the Clan one of their first downs. Don't want to lose him for the majority of a game, so. That's good news for Clan fans and Delorier's parents out there if they're listening or in the stands. He's doing okay, and he'll be back on the field shortly.
So Aaron Martin, our sideline reporter, with the news on Delorier. This Simon Fraser team, though, needs to start doing something here offensively. It's as simple as it sounds, Nick. Snap by snap's the only way they can look at it right now.
And really what's been working, Howie, is these short passes, quick releases, not much in the run game. So maybe some more swing passes, quick hooks, getting Richardson moving.
Richardson, a deep ball there to Buren, overthrows him at about the Humboldt State 40-yard line, so we'll be back to the line of scrimmage for second down. So second and 10 now for Simon Fraser.
And just trying to get the ball into the hands of their playmakers. That's Buren, Delorier out there as well. Quick passes in Richardson and maybe do some rolls, and we've seen him use his feet. Maybe he can utilize that against this very athletic Humboldt team.
Cobb in motion as Richardson gets the snap. Quickly, the pass off to Jana. He is going to get past the line of scrimmage, gain about maybe 2 yards on that pass. Delorier running to gain 2 yards.
And that's about the only type of play they've seen success with here, Howie. Other than that first drive where they strung a couple good plays together, that swing pass to the running back nets him about a yard. But again, a third and long, which is going to be difficult to convert against this tough defense.
It is tough, isn't it? You're just teeing it up for the defense, Nick. They can't run the ball and they can't go vertical.
And that defensive line who's got pressure is just going to pin their ears back and really run after Richardson. So maybe we look for a Richardson boot or a scramble here. Maybe we can get the Humboldt facing the wrong way in their defensive backfield, and Richardson can scramble for a first down here.
Third and 9 here for the Clan. Richardson is already having to run for his life back there. He escapes the pressure, but he's going to get sacked back at about the 14-yard line. So Buell there to deliver the final blow as the Simon Fraser Clan just unable to get anything going offensively. We're just a minute and a half here into the second quarter of play. Could be a long night for the Clan defense.
And Richardson just under pressure right from the start there. Howie didn't have much of a chance. And a lot of go routes there from the wide receiver, so not much help as he scrambled. Nobody turned around, came back to that ball. So tough three and out there to start this drive in the second quarter.
Punting from about their own 5-yard line. So that's going to go out of bounds in Simon Fraser territory. Boy, great field position again for Humboldt State.
Yeah, starting another drive inside the Clan end. Going to be first and 10 from the 40, Howie.
So another short field for the Lumberjacks to work with here, already leading 28-0. Of course, Humboldt State opening their GNAC campaign with a loss at Azusa against Azusa Pacific last week. So a tough contest for them to start the season, but they certainly look like one of the dominant teams in this conference.
It looks like they came out here angry, Howie, running the ball down the throat of the Clan here. Backup quarterback in for the Jacks here. That's number 14.
And Doctor with
Adam
the carry
Wood,
there, Richard Doctor.
And Doctor, again, another backup there for the Jacks, getting his first action of the game, a nice 3-yard run for him.
Well, Doctor had only had 9 carries for 14 yards in the first 2 games of the season. So a good chance perhaps for Humboldt State to work some of their other guys in, get them some reps in live game action here.
And you see right at the end of that replay, Herdman getting up and trying to fire up the troops, laying a big lick on the running back there. Hopefully they can get some inspiration from that play.
Wood stays in at quarterback. Wood with the ball. He's going to just cover and duck. He's going to gain about 4 yards on the play, it looks like. Getting down to about the 34-yard line of the Simon Fraser Clan.
Yeah, not much there. Good coverage by the Clan. Wood decided not to hand the ball off there, and he probably regretted that. Tucked the ball and fell forward for a gain of a couple.
So Doctor again in the backfield here. 3 receivers to the near side of the field as Wood goes back to pass, slings it through the middle, and he's got a man. Did that skip off the turf?
Yeah, incomplete there. Howie Wood looked like he had a receiver there, but just unable to grab it.
He was looking for Zuvrink, number 6 there. Put a bit of mustard on that one, but didn't make the completion. So fourth down. And
not quite field goal range, but not quite worth it to punt here, Howie. So they're going to go for it again on fourth down, 4th and 4.
It's been their MO the whole game. Here's Wood looking back, throwing to the sidelines and unable to find his man. Skipping that low pass off the turf.
And there we go, Howie. Finally a 3 and out there for the Clan defense. That's hopefully a bit of momentum. The needle can come back a bit towards the Clan side for that momentum. But, you know, it's been a rough quarter there, but finally the Clan get the defensive stop here and don't allow a touchdown by the Jacks.
Well, Weber and Gardner put their passing and rushing yards together, and you're pushing past 5,000 yards last season. Put their second string guys in, and maybe things won't work as sharply here. So the Clan taking over, decent field position from their own 34-yard line. Oh, and he's going to get sacked back there. The ball is loose, but the Clan fall on it.
And that was number 56.
Ooh, but Humboldt is still saying they have the football, and indeed the officials are signaling they do. I don't know if we got a replay of that game, but it really looked like the Clan had gotten the ball back.
Oh, he kind of, yeah, it was, I think, one of the offensive linemen there. I think that was Christensen. Unable to fall on it, Howie. Snuck through his hands and through his legs. And, boy, that's a tough break on first down, Howie.
That is a tough one.
A turnover in your own end. And giving the Jacks the ball at your own 27-yard line.
Well, again, we hate to say it, but this has been commonplace throughout the opening stages of this game. Incredibly great field position here for Humboldt State. They're getting the bounces as well. Doctor again, this time is going to get dragged down, and a nice tackle there by the Simon Fraser Clan's Tyrell Radich, number 41.
Robert Weber back in at quarterback for the Jacks. But, yeah, good play there by Clan number 41. That's Radich there coming in from that defensive end spot, shuffling down and making a nice tackle right in the line of scrimmage.
Keeps it at second and 10 here. As we mentioned, Weber back into the game. Here he comes. He's got Doctor, the pass off the mark. And a little bit of rust here in this offense right now from Humboldt State. They're getting things handed to them on a silver platter, Nick, but they're not as effective as they were in their first four possessions.
I mean, at 28-0, Howie, we'll take what we can get here. But, yeah, didn't quite look like quarterback was able to get his feet set on that one, and that's good. Maybe a little bit of happy feet there. Clan brought a couple extra rushers and unable to complete the pass.
Trips to the near side of the field here as Weber back in at quarterback. Doctor, the running back, steps up, throws down, looks for Doctor, and he's got it for the touchdown! 27 yards. Weber to Doctor down the far side of the field, and just like that, another touchdown on the board, the fifth of the game. 34-0 our score here for Humboldt State.
And that was the linebacker Kemp out in coverage. I think that's, was that the wide receiver on a wheel route there? Or no, that's the running back, number 21, out of the backfield.
Sure, Doctor comes out of the backfield.
Doctor comes out of the backfield and just unable to stay with him. Kemp out of Chula Vista, California, unable to stay with that quick running back down the field. And, you know, quarterback lays that in there for another touchdown for the Jacks, taking us to a 35-0 as that extra point is knocked through the uprights with just about 11 minutes left here.
So the linebacker on the running back on a pass play, Humboldt State's getting it done. And Kemp, I believe, is a guy who scored on the block kick against
Yeah, he was the guy who had the block kick last week. And I've been there, a linebacker on a running back in coverage. It's never a fun thing. They're typically faster than you. So, that is a tough matchup, and unfortunately unable to, you know, man coverage down the field, the D-line unable to get pressure, and Kemp there unable to stay with the running back into the end zone. And a nice throw by the quarterback, too, on a deep pass there.
Nick Sersky, of course, linebacker at Queen's University, won a Vanier Cup, and brings his expertise here to Clan TV. 35-0 is the score here, 11 minutes to the half, and well, that half can't come quick enough for Simon Fraser.
I played a lot of bench warmer, Howie, not a ton of linebacker, but but alas, in practice, I was a good linebacker. Yeah, it's good.
And we'll talk about your injuries at some point during this broadcast as well.
I could take up the rest of the time if we wanted to. No.
Well, Humboldt State will kick off. Lagu and Cobb back, 32-11 back to receive here. It's going to go to Gavin Cobb. He's taking a knee, but this time comes out. He's going to take it at his 1-yard line and look for an open space here. Cobb up the middle is going to get dropped at about the 17-yard line, it looks like. Gavin Cobb out of Mount Douglas, pure freshman in the BC High School AAA Football Player of the Year in 2015.
And maybe, Howie, you can talk a bit more about Cobb. He had a great senior season there in high school, and coming to the Clan, I don't know if we knew too much about him coming into the season, but he's really, he's led the team in receiving yards, or not receiving yards, but receptions, and is getting targeted quite often from that wide receiver
competitive
spot.
Competitive grit, athlete, like a guy across down at UBC named Marcus Davis, same high school, by the way, just a guy who's an athlete who can play a number of different positions. Here's Richardson. This time it looked like he was looking for Cobb. He's going to just throw it to the sidelines,
They just called it. That was a great play there by the linebacker there, Howie.
And you look at how close number 33, Connor Cox, came to making that interception.
Came out of nowhere to make that play, but luckily enough for Richardson that gets out of bounds.
As you look at it on the replay here on Clan TV, yeah, talk about not giving up on the play.
He made that catch, but just a couple feet out of bounds. good play by Cox.
Wow. So second and 10 from the 18 here for Simon Fraser. So Jayla Janna this time finding some space, and Janna down the field. He's going to cross the 40 up to the 50-yard line. Jalen Janna, the biggest offensive play of the night, Nick, for the Simon Fraser Clan.
Getting the ball past midfield there, Howie, and that was a great play. We'll see the replay here. Nice cutback by Janna through the middle and hops over a tackler there. Down the field, some good downfield blocking there as well. Great play on second down to gain a first down in a while here, Howie, in the second quarter.
Somebody just opened the door and let a gust of wind in, a fresh air for this Clan offense. They needed that.
Just to give their defense a break too, Howie. They've been on the field a while here, and good to see the offense putting a bit of a drive together.
Great point, Nick, from the Humboldt State 49 on first and 10. A fake there by Richardson. He's going to go to the sidelines, finds a man and has him. It looks like it is Buren on the sideline making a tough diving catch.
That's a nice play, Howie. Richardson fakes the pitch here and rolls out. And again, we talked about this is what he can do. He can get outside the pockets, mobile and accurate on the run. Throws where only Buren's going to catch that ball. Buren slides down right near the first down marker, makes that catch, and another first down for the Clan.
Yeah, Justin Buren come back to the marker there, making a great catch as he's fallen to the ground. First and 10 SFU from the Humboldt State 39. Great run there by Janna to set things up here. This time the pitch to Janna. He's going to cut it up the middle, and Janna finds room and has a very close to a first down there, Nick. He had some nice running at the end of that play to stretch out towards the marker.
Well, and you run that fake pitch on the play before, and then you run the real pitch, and Humboldt may be thinking it's the same play over again. So they do out-leverage the Jacks there on that right side and able to run for a nice gain of 8 yards. Cuts up inside that nice block by number 65. That's Christensen, the right tackle, making a good kick block there. Janna cutting up outside, planting that right foot in the ground and getting some positive yards.
Well, it's second and about a yard and a half here for the Clan. Their nicest march of the game. Richardson back. He's going to throw to the sidelines. Has a man again. It's Buren. And Buren's going to get knocked out of bounds, but not before he gets the first down and more down to about the 18-yard line.
Yeah, and a nice comeback route there by Buren again. The Clan able to protect Richardson a little bit longer there. He had some time in the pocket. Was able to see that nice comeback route there by Buren. A nice reception and another first down for the Clan.
Great creativity there from Joe Powell, the offensive coordinator, the rest of that Simon Fraser Clan offense, getting things going here for the first time this evening. So the first down has them at the Humboldt State 19-yard line. Richardson looks like he's going to keep it, and he's going to take a hard hit up the middle there after a gain of about 3 yards.
That was actually Janna lined up there in the backfield on a little wildcat.
A little wildcat action there. Jalen Janna.
Yeah. We see it on the replay there. Lined up in tandem in the backfield with number 22, Cassetti. And Janna able to get a little decent run there on first down, second and about 8.
Well, you know what? At least it's putting something in the thoughts and minds of the defensive side of the ball at Humboldt State. And Simon Fraser, as you mentioned, being as resourceful as they can. And if they're being outmanned physically, they're finding ways to get it done here.
And they're in it again here. You'll see Richardson out as a wide receiver here.
Here's Janna with the ball. He's taken the snap, and he's going to the sidelines and battling for that first down.
Kind of looked like he had a little run pass option there, Howie. It almost looked like he hesitated, wanted to throw that ball, but saw that opening on the right side and was able to scramble for, you know, 5-6 yards. 3 yards.
Jeez, I thought he had gained more. I thought he was closer. Boy.
Third and five now. And a big spot here for the Clan. You're hoping that you won't settle for field goal attempts down in the red zone. Hopefully we can punch one into the end zone.
Well, this time from the 14-yard line, and Richardson looks like he's back at quarterback. He's got Buren to the near side of the field. Here's Jana. Just really couldn't get going there on that play, Nikki.
It's tough. Yeah. We'll see what we're going to do here, Howie. It is fourth down, fourth and about two, but it looks like the offense is going to stay on the field. And, I mean, at this point, at 35-0, might as well see what you can get here. 3 points isn't going to do much. And leaving your offense on the field try and get more than just three on this drive.
Having a guy like Leetray in a situation like this would be nice, a bit of a power back if Clan don't have it. We've got Jana in the backfield with Richardson. Timeout being called here on the field. We'll keep it right here as the Simon Fraser Clan on their deepest drive of the football game. 6:34 remaining to the half. Howard Samura, Nick Sirski here on Clan TV. And you know what? A great vibe in the gym. We should talk about Red Knight. A couple of nights ago in that West Gym. Boy, what a great job to get the Simon Fraser fans and, you know, the senior, the athletes as well in that gym. It was a great atmosphere.
Yeah, it was a great feeling down there, Howie. Wednesday nights probably had about 800 fans in there. And first win against Western Washington in 11 games over 6 years. Western Washington came in as a ranked opponent. I'm not sure what their ranking was, Howie, but they're up there in the national ranking. And the Clan able to make a big statement win early on in the season, and they look good, 8-1 to start the year, our women's volleyball team.
And you know, I was telling the athletic director, Steve Frost, what's going on? All your teams, soccer, men and women, both playing so well, the men nationally ranked. Great things happening on campus at Simon Fraser University. Catch it, soccer and volleyball right now in season. As we get back to action here on the football field from Swangard Stadium.
Hopefully we'll get a score for you in the men's soccer game at halftime. They are in action tonight against Hawaii Pacific. We'll update you just after halftime.
Final game of that non-conference swing for head coach Clint Schneider and company is Richardson now quickly to Jana. He's got some real estate. Jana, nice move by Jalen Jana. Looks like he's got the first down, first and goal situation for Simon Fraser.
And that's that swing pass again, Howie, that's been successful. Getting Jana that ball in space, able to make a tackler miss and convert that pivotal fourth down play, and now we have first down inside the 10-yard line. We haven't seen much of the Clan red zone offense, only able to get inside the red zone twice last week with a field goal made and a field goal missed. So we'll see what the Clan decide to do here deep into Humboldt territory.
Well, certainly we get bears mentioning the Clan have not scored an offensive touchdown on the season through two games. It looks like they've got Ryzen John, the 6'7" wide receiver, lined up on the far side of the field. They're going to hand it off to Jana, and he's not going to go anywhere. He's going to lose about 3 or 4 yards on the play. I'm sorry, you bring a 6'7" wide receiver on the field? He dwarfs Megatron, okay? Ryzen John out of Vancouver College is huge.
He's a big kid there, and yeah, he's into the game again here, Howie. We'll see. Maybe they'll toss up a jump ball to him a la your favorite Detroit Lions, Calvin Johnson, Megatron. See what they can do with him. He's lined up to the wide side of the field here.
Franklin also in there on the far side of the field, along with Buren to the near side. Second down here for the Clan. The handoff to Jana. He's trying to do some power running up the middle. He is going to get wrestled down at about the 8-yard line.
Looked like he had a little bit of room there, Howie, but he wasn't able to hit that hole probably as hard as he wanted to. And brought down after a gain of just about one or two here. We'll see that replay. He had some daylight, but nice tackle there by number 18 of the Jacks. It was Charles on the tackle. We'll see what they do here on third down.
Third down, Simon Fraser, best scoring opportunity of the season. Richardson takes the snap. Looks like he wants to pass, but he is going to get taken down in a storm of Humboldt State players. And looks like he's going to get taken down at about the 17. Nick, the Clan are going backwards.
And we've had good coverage sack there by Humboldt, and they're able to get some pressure. A little bit of trouble with the snap here, Howie. Beck is unable to get that ball back super quick, and Richardson has to wait for that ball, probably throwing off his drop back a little bit. And we'll see what they can do here on fourth down, and they're lining up to kick this field goal.
Here's Spink here for the field goal attempt. And it is good. The Simon Fraser Klein will get on the scoreboard, but there is a flag on the field.
This will probably be after the play. Howie, I'm not sure if they're going to count the field goal. We'll see what Mr. Referee says here.
After the play, unsportsmanlike, on the kicking team, number 89.
Trying to figure out which player it was, but it's against Simon Fraser. Was it Farden Godyev? It might have been. I saw 89 Godyev in number 5.
Yeah, I think
Burmeister,
they
coming together.
They did call it on 89 there, Howie. And boy, that's just penalties that you can't have on sportsmanlike conduct after the play on a field goal attempt.
You're down 35-0. You just kicked the field goal. Put your head down and keep working.
Yeah.
Tough break there for Simon Fraser, 35-3. But hey, we got to take things for the way they are here. And they you know what? They were in a position where they needed to have something happen offensively. Got a big play from Jana, and they went down and they put some points on the board. They've got to build off that.
Needed to put some points on the board and put a drive together, keep the ball out of the Humboldt State hands, and able to put something together. Unfortunately, they're going to be pushed back here on the kickoff. But the Klein showing some positives there, able to get Richardson out in space. Nice couple completions to Buren. So we'll see if they can build on that throughout the end of this second quarter here and into the second half.
Looks like Zuvrink and Doctor back to return the kickoff from the Klein. We don't have a 38 listed here by the Klein on their kickoff. They're going to squib it along the ground, and they will just cover it up. Will the Broncos, or rather the Lumberjacks, sorry about that, at their own 44-yard line.
That's so, number 38 kicking there, Howie. We don't actually have that on the roster. I'll have to see who that is to even talk to a coach at halftime. But, yeah, the Klein trying to maybe avoid a big return there by the Jacks, squibbing that ball to midfield. We'll see what the Jack can do here with just over 4 minutes left, 4:04 left in the second quarter, going towards halftime, what they can do with this drive.
Well, a three and out would be a huge, huge thing for this Klein defense, which has really worked hard but just been outmatched here in the opening half of play. Weber with the pass to the sidelines. Zuvrink looks like he's got enough for the first down, Dylan Zuvrink. Little page out of the Klein book there. Short little pass to the sidelines. Good enough for the first down to move the chains here.
Well,
or are they
going to
call it just short?
Just
sorry
short.
About that. So second and about a half yard, it looks like, at the Klein 46-yard line.
That is a bit of a bizarre spot there.
It's the Klein, a strange spot. It sure looked like a first down. Yeah. Weber now. High snap is going to hand it off. Ooh, and tumbling as he goes to the ground after getting the first down.
Flag on the play, though, Howie. I think this is going to be a hold against Humboldt. I think this will get taken back. I think it was on number 70.
70, Sam Madden, the offensive lineman, the junior out of Fresno, California.
Yeah, it'll be 10 yards back, Howie, and a nice little break there for the Klein. Won't allow the Jacks to get that first down.
I think they called that against Shane Torrey, number 95. Either way, positive for the Klein here. So second and 7 from the Humboldt State 47-yard line. Weber awaiting the snap. Quick little pass to Doctor in the backfield. Doctor is going to get hit. Great pursuit there by the Klein's number 48, Justin Herdman.
And that's the Herdman twins. Jordan forcing back, the running back into the field of play.
and the other Herdman coming in and laying a smackdown on the running back there on that swing pass. Nice play. So
this Clan defense, Nick, they got to be happy with this. They're in a third, you know, they've brought third down here with a chance to make a bit of a defensive statement after the tough start they got.
Yeah, and, you know, they've been handed a tough hand here with the drive starting at midfield. Hopefully a big stop on third down.
Ooh, somebody jumped. We see a flag late coming out. They're all over the field now.
I think that was SFU jump there in the left end.
Yeah, going against Simon Fraser.
That was 34. And that was Kemp again. Edge rusher there just jumped, and that'll make it a more manageable third down here, third and one.
Third and one now, so a chance to keep this drive going. So Weber, that quarterback, has Doctor as the lone man in the backfield, trips to the high side of the field for Humboldt State. Hand off to Doctor right into the line of scrimmage, and he was met there and pushed back, but he might have gotten it.
It's going to be close here, Howie. Looks like the refs are coming in a little bit short of that marker. It's actually basically right in front of us here. I think it looks a bit short, but we'll get a measurement and they'll bring the they won't even bring the chains in. They're not going to do a measurement. It is fourth down, but probably the Humboldt looks like they're going to.
Oh, nice spot there if you're a Clan fan. And
Humboldt looks like their offense is going to stay on the field. Play clock running down to about 15 seconds. And Humboldt not even at the line yet. See what happens.
See what happens here. Humboldt State's made a habit of going for it on fourth down, and they've converted.
Well, it looks like they're going to take a wind the clock down and take a timeout here. Now.
So 1:38 here left to the half from Swangard Stadium. Simon Fraser really, though, has slowed a bit of this momentum. You talked about tempo coming into this game, Nick, and was that going to play havoc on the depth of this Clan defense? You really got your take your hat off to this Clan defense. Take away a couple of those big plays, and they really have had to just suck it up and do what they can here in this opening half.
Exactly. When you're down 28-0 after the first quarter, you've been dealt a pretty tough hand. You know, 7-3 in the second quarter, that's progress. Something that they're going to have to work on moving ahead is getting, obviously, a stop here on fourth down. Maybe get some points here for a field goal attempt here before the end of the half, but then moving that into the second half, seeing what they can do on offense and putting some more drives together, and more importantly, keeping this dangerous Humboldt offense off the field.
So fourth down now for Humboldt State, and certainly the odds look in their favor of converting here. They've done it three or four times already this evening. Out of the shotgun, Weber the handoff. Up the middle,
he
is met and pushed back. Great job by the Clan. It looks like
that's the Herdman twins there. 48 and 57. Both the Herdmans here. Howie will get the replay. Way to rally up and get some good penetration there. That hit happened, 2 yards in the backfield. Number 90 made a good play, as well as 57 got in there. That's 90. That's Wilson with some good penetration into the backfield. And the got a good stop here, and 1:34 left on the clock. I believe the Clan have 2 timeouts left in this half, and so they could use those here and get a field goal attempt or better yet, even a touchdown.
Well, let's see what kind of a 2-minute offense they have here. 1:34 left, and Simon Fraser with an opportunity here. Buren and Franklin to the high side of the field. Fake to Jana. Richardson looking to the sidelines, and a little miscommunication there. Buren and the Richardson just didn't seem to be in sync on that play, Nick.
Yeah, and it looked like they had Franklin again open over the middle. No Franklin running some kind of deep drags about 10 yards down the field, but Richardson unable to see him and going to Buren on that wide side, unable to make that completion.
Well, it took a few seconds off the clock. Second down and 10 from their own 47-yard line. Getting ready for some pressure here. The handoff to Jana. He's running to the sidelines. Jana's got some room. A first down and more for Jalen Jana across midfield. Great play. Great play calling here from the Simon Fraser Clan.
That's a nice play. Caught Humboldt. Caught me off guard, too. I thought they were going to be throwing the ball here late in the second quarter here. But Jana able to take that little draw and cut around the left side. Good blocking there by Gakusana there on the left side. Able to create that edge and get out of bounds to stop the clock, too.
Well, Gakusana, one of those veterans, one of the few they have on that line to create some things for them offensively. You're right about that, Nick, as Buren lines up to the near side of the field here. Snap to Richardson, the handoff to Jenna. This time cuts it up in the inside, and Jalen Jenna showing some nice plant and some good courage going up the middle.
Yeah, exactly. Jenna's had some decent runs here in the second quarter. Was pretty much stifled in the first, but maybe that Humboldt front getting a little bit tired. The clan able to get some good yardage on that first ball.
So call it about second and a long five here from the Humboldt 33, it looks like, with 53 seconds remaining to the half. Again to Jana, dancing, looking to push forward, and he got some positive yardage down to just outside the 30-yard line. We'll see where they spot it.
Klein will take a timeout here, Howie, to stop the clock on coming up on a big third down play here. See the
Jana
replay. Yeah, Jana, a little good way to scamper up, getting positive yardage. There was some penetration by that Humboldt State defensive line, but able to dance around that a bit and fall forward and make it a very third and manageable third and four, third and three here late with about 38 seconds left in the first half.
Well, I'll tell you, if you want a game film of push on that offensive line and, you know, consistent offensive running plays over the first two games of the season, you weren't going to find them until today. You've got something to build on here, and Jana really showing something.
And the Simon Fraser's offensive line isn't the biggest one out there, but a good way to make levels, and Jana able to dance around some of the onslaught that was the Humboldt State D-line and make some good plays here in the second quarter.
Jalen Jana, a Surrey native who's come back home here, join this Simon Fraser Clan team in the offensive backfield as the Clan march out onto the field on third down. Third and about four here, three and a half perhaps. Cosette, the running back, is going to fake the handoff. This time they'll throw a pass and it goes through the hands. Of Andrew Pauls, the tight end.
It was wide open in the flat there, Howie, but unable. He came across from the fullback spot on the left side, running across a drag route to the right, but unable to hold on to that. Obviously going to go for it here on fourth down. Fourth and four with 32 seconds left.
Here is Gavin Cobb and Buren lining up to the near side of the field. Richardson looks downfield, wants it all to Cobb. Oh, and through the hands of Gavin Cobb at the goal line. Tough break for the Clan on fourth down.
And he had Cobb early, Howie, and it looked like the pressure got to him a bit. He had to hesitate and then got it. He just had a little bit of a hesitation there, Howie. But look at that arm off his back foot. Throws that ball 40 yards. Cobb unable to come down with that one. And the turnover on downs here with 26 seconds left in the first half. You expect Humboldt probably just to kneel the ball out here to get us to halftime.
Well, that certainly would have been huge for this Clan team who have really rallied the forces here in the second quarter of play. Had Cobb, the pure freshman, lined up there right at the goal line and unable to get that done as we're down to 26 seconds left in the first half of play. Weber taking a shot down the field, wants a big play, and it's, oh, and he's got a man down at the 32-yard line.
Pass looked to flutter a bit, but able to fall to that back shoulder fade, and that's a tough play for the defender out there on that wide side corner. Almost unable to make a play on that one, and they're going to have to run the hurry-up offense here with about 18 seconds left.
Nick Sexton with a big catch, a pure freshman making that catch. Stumble on that snap. Weber improvising, looks to the other side of the field, and they can't hold on to the ball. Sexton can't squeeze that one. And we're down to 12 seconds remaining. Sexton, a big catch, the All-Cajun California freshman. So you just expect verticality here in this over the next few seconds here.
Yeah, well, they're at the point where they'll have to take a couple shots. I believe they do have a timeout left, Howie. So maybe, you know, a mid-range shot here, take a timeout, and either kick that field goal or try for the end zone.
Here is Weber from the 35. Another pass into the end zone, this time to number five, and he's going to hold on for the touchdown. Oh.
No, incomplete in the back of the end zone there. Good play by that defensive back. Getting his hands in there. It looked like it was going to be complete, Howie. It fooled me at first as well, but the defensive back there can't quite catch the number on the replay. 46.
46 from the Simon Fraser clan. The great play defensively. Gabe Lopes.
Yeah, good play there down the field. Able to rip that ball away from that receiver and take away that potential touchdown play. Big play there in the end zone.
Well, a threat right down to the last second. Humboldt State with a 35-3 lead here. Jaquan Gardner, RB1, has spent a lot of time on the sidelines. They have been resting him. Going instead with the running back, Richard Doctor, on a number of occasions. And Zaire as well. Blair Zaire, the senior out of Morgan Hill, California, as well, has gotten a lot of reps at running back for Humboldt State. So Southward here set to try and kick a field goal.
It's a big one, Howie. 53
yards. This is a
53-yarder
they're lining up for. Final play of the first half, and the kick is going to fall short.
What a big leg by that kid, but just short. That'll take us into halftime.
Died a little bit there. 35-3 is our score at the half. And we will keep it here for just a brief second, Nick, and just chat about this Simon Fraser team. I mean, we keep thinking back to Kingsville last week in a 40-0 deficit at the end of the first quarter. And then we get Jaquan Gardner, 82 yards on the first play of the game. SFU heart sank, I think, at that point. But really, Simon Fraser, I think, has developed a bit of mental fortitude here. And they did show you something mentally in terms of their stick-to-itiveness.
Well, exactly. And, you know, that first quarter, obviously a shock to Simon Fraser going in, being 28-0 into the first quarter break there. But able to, you know, stay in the game with the Jacks, only being outscored 7-3. In that second quarter, putting a really good drive together, getting into the red zone, and getting some points on the board, which is more than they got in the first quarter. So looking to build on those positives in that first half. Really, Jana had a great second quarter there. We're hoping he can build on that into the second half. And Richardson looking a little bit more comfortable back there, getting some better protection. So maybe those schemes with that offensive line that they're running are working out a bit better. And Richardson getting some more time to find those receivers, Buren and Cobb, down the field.
Last thing is, before we head into the break, is just talk about that chemistry developing between Richardson and the receivers. Everything was not that much off, it seemed, in the first half. If it gets there, how much of a difference can it make?
Exactly. And you know, Richardson has been with the team for 4 weeks, but it's not like he's a fifth-year or fourth-year starter here in this system. And so he's going to have to get comfortable with the language, getting comfortable with, you know, being on the same page of the Burens and the Cobbs and the Pauls in the flat there, unable to, you know, make that catch. So working on that comfortability with your receivers is going to take time. It's not something that you're just, you know, magically born with. So they're going to have to work on that in this second half of this game, and then moving out throughout the rest of this regular season, and build on that for his confidence and the confidence of the team.
Well, 35-3 our score at the halftime. Howard Simmer and Nick Sirski, we're going to send it to break at this point and be back before the start of the second half.
If I lose, I'll respond with respect.
If I win, I'll back it up with humility.
If I fail, I'll rise up with honor. It's tough for us to put it all on the line.
Don't undo my hard work with poor sportsmanship.
Respect. It's the name of the game.
Hi, I'm Michaela Guerrero, a member of the women's soccer team, and I'm here alongside my teammates as well as athletes from women's basketball, volleyball, and football showing our support for the Fraser Valley Walk for ALS.
So SAC and a bunch of the student athletes are here to help out with the Fraser Valley Walk for ALS today. And it's a great way to just get involved with the community and give back. And especially when you have someone like Saint who's given so much to us at the equipment desk. So it's the least we could do just to say thank you and of course give back to a great cause like ALS.
Well, I started about 15 years ago and I just started like working with the ALS Society of BC. And it's such a great family, and I got to know all about ALS, and I got to realize how much people really needed the help, like not just the person who has ALS, but the family and the kids, and it just everybody's affected by it. 40% of the money that we raised today for this walk goes directly into research. The other 60% goes directly into patient care. So that's like wheelchairs, computers to help the speech, all types of medical equipment. So 100% of the money from all the walks always goes straight to something that's going to help.
What does it mean to you to see so many student athletes from SFU here?
Awesome, you're going to make me cry. I'm actually really, I am going to cry. Feels really good. Stop.
Today was such a great day having all the support from SFU Athletics out here at the ALS Walk. I hope going forward that we can continue to offer support and help to great initiatives like this.
Show, 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 we're gonna know it. Cameron Prosivia was a rather ordinary high school athlete. He didn't qualify for the 800-meter final, and he finished over 100 places behind the cross-country champion his senior year. For most individuals, this story would probably end here. But look what happens when hard work and perseverance meets opportunity.
There's no better feeling than like succeeding in what you put your mind to. A lot of people have untapped talent in track, and if they just gave it the chance, they could have a lot of success.
A favor to a high school coach, Perseviat came to SFU as a walk-on. 4 years later, he is the lead runner on Canada's NCAA track and field team.
Rather than falling in love with running, I've fallen in love with the improvement. I mean, that's what gets you out the door every day. It's the wanting to be better, wanting to beat the other people.
Prosiviat broke 1 minute 50 to finish 11th in the 800 at his first nationals, and at the indoor championships, he was an All-American. Today, he is the 2016 Bill DeVries Male All-Round Athlete winner. Prosiviat is one of the clan's top scholars with a 3.9 GPA. School is something he works at every day.
I kind of want to break the myth that you're just born with being able to do well in school. I think what I want a lot of people to realize is that it's not just about how smart you are, it's actually about how passionate you are and how well you know yourself.
Whether as a learning coach, president of SAC, or in the community, Cameron lifts those people around him, and that is the mark of a true champion.
I actively work with a Special Olympics group in Burnaby, where we coach them like biomechanics and track in different events. I've worked with a local track club and helped the elementary students with their running. And again, it's more just like a get them active, less focused on like serious aspects of track, but more just get them to have a love for running.
So what does SFU mean to Cam?
I'm from Burnaby, so Simon Fraser, I grew up here, coming to the summer camps every year. It's always been basically part of the community, and that's what I'd say, it's like home.
My vision for the men's basketball program at SFU is success and being sustainable. And I think what that means is building a new tradition here where the players coming in have, number one, the goal of graduating with an SFU degree. Vancouver and SFU is the greatest university in the GNAC by far. And we got to make sure that our players from outside of BC see that, and we have to make sure that they know what SFU is all about. The word team to me means family. You know, it starts with building relationships off the court before we get on the court. Has a lot to do with trust, being straightforward with players as far as where we see them fitting into our program. We want players that are going to play for each other. In order to build long-term success, we need some players that can come in, deal with some of the tough times that are going to happen with a growing program. We have to show some attributes of a great person like Terry Fox, who I think taught us all as Canadians that, you know, we can get through those tough times, and each individual can make a huge difference in somebody else's life. It doesn't take talent to do what he did. It takes a lot of perseverance, again, mental toughness and grit. And we need some players that have a common vision of doing things great, whether it's, you know, performing as a basketball team or doing something great in the community. That takes a group of guys that doesn't want shortcuts. So we have to do our research and make sure that we get the right type of people in our program, from coaches all the way down to players.
It's on us to stop sexual violence.
We are Canada's NCAA team.
With 400 student athletes in 17 sports.
Together, we can end sexual violence at SFU.
To look out for each other.
And not look the other way.
To get a friend home safe.
To not blame the victim.
It's on us.
It's on us.
To speak up.
To step in.
To support those who need it.
To be a part of the solution, not the problem.
It's on me, it's on you, it's on us.
Because consent matters.
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 Learn more about how you can contribute to a culture of zero tolerance towards sexual violence at SFU by visiting sfu.ca/sexualassault.
Because together, we can make a difference.
The road to greatness is not marked by perfection, but by the ability to constantly overcome adversity and failure to get better. So never give up and never give in. I am Ben Meiniger, and I am ready for the new season.
This is Jordan Pugh from the football team, and you're watching Clan TV, home of Canada's NCAA team.
Coming together is a beginning. Keeping together is progress. Working together is success. A successful team beats with one heart and believes in one goal, together. I'm Caitlin Erhardson, and I'm ready for the new season.
Champions are laser-focused, motivated, excited about winning, and resilient toward setbacks and failures. It's about doing your best and discovering you have more to give. I am Oliver Jorgensen, and I'm ready for the new season.
And welcome back, everybody, to Swangard Stadium. The second half about 4 minutes away from happening. Humboldt State with a 35-3 lead. Football season, but basketball season beckons. Coach Hansen, you are embarking on your first season as head coach here at Simon Fraser. Thanks for stopping by on Clan TV. What's it like right now getting ready to be the head coach of this basketball team?
Yeah, well, it's super exciting time. The future is coming up real quick for our team, and it's outstanding getting out to support our football team. It's kind of, basketball season, the start of it is starts kind of with football, so it's that time of year. It started to get a little colder out, and we just got going with our workouts last week, and we're only 4 weeks away from our first practice, so getting really excited.
Yeah, and if you were to think of a theme for this coming season or a mantra that you would like to establish with your players and really have that permeate through your program, what would you say that would be?
Yeah, growth. I mean, we're a young group this year, and looking at our football team, I mean, there's some talent there. It's just that they have so many young guys, and when you look at Humboldt, you can see a lot of juniors and seniors, a lot of men, and we're in a similar situation. But we brought in some junior transfers this year that'll give us some age and some girth at certain positions, and So we just want to grow. And, you know, our pace of all our workouts and our conditioning right now has been really good. And we really like the aura around our team right now. And all the new guys that have come in have really bought into what we're going to be about. And what I really love about our team is there's a lot of guys that really love about leading by service. Mm-hmm. And we got five guys working down there right now. Four guys at the game here. Yeah, we got four guys being ball boys and doing stats this game, so it's great to see the leadership outside the court.
We've got about a minute here before we have to get back to the football game, but familiar names. Are we going to see many familiar faces from that clan team? If so, let us know who's back from last season's clan team.
Yeah, absolutely. So Tyrell Lewin, who was a true freshman last year, he'll be back at the power forward center position. Our lone senior, Jabron Sawani, he'll be back. We have a lot of guys at the guard position. So we have a guy that's had an outstanding offseason, a kid from Delta, Bowen Backen. I've seen a ton of growth in him in the offseason. He's in great shape. He's playing with confidence, shooting the ball outstanding. So I'm really excited for him. And then as far as returners go, I mean, J.J. Pankratz is a guy that we're looking forward to be like a first-team conference all-star. I think we really rose the expectations with him in the offseason and told him not only does he have to be a leader, but he's got to lead us in kind of every category this year. And, you know, I think he's really taken those high expectations and added to everything he does working out. Shooting shots, he's excited for this season.
Well, so. A nice core. I know, you know, there were some tough times last season, but we, certainly, you know, it looks like things are moving forward in a real positive direction. We're happy to have you aboard here, and all the best this season.
Thanks, Howard. Yeah, I appreciate it. And our first home game, October 29th, we're playing local Douglas College, and they have a new head coach there, Joe Envoltson, who I know real well, and it'll be neat to see this new group of guys come together and see what they can do this year.
All right, Coach Hansen, thanks for stopping by Clan TV. Basketball season is around the corner. Football getting set to start the second half here. Simon Fraser and Humboldt State here from Swangard Stadium. And as we welcome back our analyst on the broadcast, Nick Sersky, getting set for the kickoff here as Humboldt State gets set to receive. And Nick, we'll hit on some of those first half stats before we get going here. What jumps out at you?
I mean, Jalen Janna in the backfield, actually, you know, 68 yards, an average of 4.5 yards per carry, you know, propelled by that big 33-yarder. But, you know, it looks like the ground game is finally gaining some traction for the Clan, and that's going to be positive in the second half and moving forward this season. You know, as we mentioned, negative rushing yards in both their first two games. So, you know, really working on that running game in the second half is looking like something that's going well.
Back to receive for Humboldt State. It's going to be Doctor, number 21, Zuvrink, number 6. And the kick is caught by Doctor, and he will take a knee in the end zone. So Humboldt State starts first and 10 from their own 25.
I was also really impressed with Richardson's poise there in the second quarter. He, you know, looked a little bit rattled in that first quarter and, you know, had some issues with his consistency and throwing the ball on target, but that second quarter really came out, getting some quick throws, getting him out on a bootleg and getting on the run. So really able to get some confidence and courage in his throw and in his arm and working together, as we mentioned before, before halftime, working together with this crew in his first full season here, is going to have to work on his confidence and communication with that team. And, you know, there's nowhere to go but up here.
We'll see what happens with Miles Richardson, the lefty, the Eastern Washington transfer, who really hasn't played meaningful football up until the last 10 quarters for over a season plus after an injury at junior college last season. Humboldt State, though, just trying to make sure they've got their starters out there, and it looks to be like Weber indeed is there, as is the big guy Jaquan Gardner lining up in the backfield that can 80-plus yards to start it on that first play of the first quarter.
Yeah, he had 110 rushing yards in that first quarter, obviously aided by that big 88-yard play. But they were able to do a lot better against that run in the second quarter and, you know, rally up, make some tackles. The Herbman boys in there, you know, Radich made a couple good plays in the backfield as well. A big fourth down stop in their own end with you know, Humboldt choosing to go for it on fourth down. And so there's some good things. There's some positive things that are happening there in that second quarter. I'm really going to need to build on that here in this second half to keep this game within reach.
Well, Gardner, as Nick says, 7 for 110 and 3 touchdowns. The rest of the team were 10 carries for 50 combined yards.
But I mean, if you take away that big 87-yard play, that's 6 carries for, just over 20 yards, which isn't that fantastic. So McClan, in general, doing a pretty good job of keeping him in check. It was just that one big run that really hurt them.
Weber to Doctor on the far sidelines. Kyra Messerbero coming up and making the stop, limiting the play to about 4 yards. So call it 2nd and 6 from the Humboldt State 29-yard line. Two receivers up, two receivers down here for Weber. And Jaquan Gardner in the backfield. Jaquan gets the handoff up the middle. Here he comes. But the Clan are there to stop that quickly. It looks like number 57, Herdman, there with the tackle.
Yeah, Herdman was there. So was Trevor Kemp there. You're rallying up to make that tackle short of the first down marker. A manageable third down for Humboldt, but still, if Clan could get out of this with a 3-and-out here to start the second half, that'd be a great start.
Simon Fraser determined to do just that as Weber takes a snap, the handoff to Gardner, dances up the middle and gets first down yardage by about a yard. He gets across the 35-yard line.
Yeah, a nice run there. Gardner obviously very shifty, able to use that big, strong offensive line in front of him to get that first down and just pass that first down marker.
Well, if they have to and the games get tough, they can play him like Barry Sanders. Just keep running him. They know he's going to break the big ones.
Of course you would reference Barry Sanders.
First and 10, Humboldt State. Hand off again to Gardner up the middle. This time, great rally to the ball. He breaks free. Almost loses the football. Gardner broke free and lost control of the football for a moment.
Made that more exciting than it needed to be. Yeah, there was a Clan wrapped around his ankle there. It was number 50 for the Clan. That's Lions in the backfield. Wrapped him up. Gardner breaks free but then loses the ball, able to fall on it. Loss of just about half a yard here.
Good job by Lions out of Terry Fox there. This time the fake and the throw to the sideline. Zuvrink, they can't tackle him, and he's going to get the first down. Zuvrink must have broken 3 tackles on the sidelines.
And that's something that you teach the fundamentals of football. That's tough, breaking 3 tackles on a little hitch pass there. You got to really wrap up there. That's couldn't tell who that was that came in there and just kind of missiled his head in there. You really got to keep your head up, wrap with your arms. I think that was Meineker going for the kill shot, but came up and missed. Teaching those, Kelly Bates is, focuses on those fundamentals and making that tackle, wrapping up, would have been a third and six. Instead, it's a first down at midfield.
Jordan Herdman just limped off the field, and they will actually take a look at him here on one of the benches here as you see him coming off the field. So the heart of the Clan defense not in as Gardner gets the football, goes to the sidelines, going to outrun his coverage, and is going to be taken out of bounds after a nice, healthy gain.
And sure enough, as soon as Herdman checks out, they go to that ground game and get a nice big chunk of yardage there, 15 yards on that carry from Gardner.
Well, hopefully our sideline reporter Aaron Martin can bring us some details on Herdman's condition down there on the sidelines. Minor football getting a nice boost here and a nice connection with Clan football, and going to have a nice special guest from the BC Lions set to join us, a guy with some real GNAC roots, and it's going to be great to get Adam Big Hill of the BC Lions up here, and hopefully Nick Sirski, a former linebacker himself, would be the perfect person to talk to Adam Big Hill. Here's Gardner breaking tackles, going down the sidelines and getting knocked out of bounds just at about the 20-yard line.
And they got penetration into the backfield there, Howie, but Gardner's good. We know this. Gardner's great. Got good footwork and made that first tackler miss and scampers up for 8-9 yards there.
Yeah, and clearly the number one rusher in Division II football last year led the entire D2 ranks in rushing. You're not stopping any ordinary guy here, and Gardner's going to do this to a lot of teams in the GNAC. 35-3, first and 10 here for the Lumberjacks. We're called it second and about two. Gardner, and he is going to run past the marker, still alive until he gets knocked out of bounds, but a first down for Humboldt State. It's not a one play 88-yard touchdown run, but it is a
It's almost just as painful.
Yeah.
It's almost just as painful, Howie, you know, just getting 5 and 6 yards every carry, keeping that average well above, you know, that 3 to 4 yard mark, and getting these first downs every two downs is killing the momentum that the Clan seemed to have late in that second quarter.
First and 10 at the SFU 23. Weber has a man, but in quickly to snuff that out is the Clan defense, and we'll get a number here who made the tackle. It was, looked like it was number 50 from the Simon Fraser Clan.
Yeah, and Humboldt trying to take advantage of this pass rush here for the Clan, but the Clan able to recognize that screenplay to Gardner quite quickly. First contact there was Jordan Herdman, and then you see four or five Clan members coming in to rally up and make that tackle.
So loss of yardage line's a big part of that play as well as Weber. At about second and 14 here. Looks downfield, Weber delivers, and he's got a man, and he is gonna get dragged out of bounds at about the 3 yard line. That's Sage Burmeister, number 5.
That was a nice route by Burmeister, actually, going to that corner route to the pylon. Humboldt had some time. Some time to set his feet and launch it. One-on-one with the safety, gets his hips turned and able to make that nice catch, and now down inside the 5.
First and goal here as they give it to Gardner. Gardner's going to change his direction, plant and go up the middle, and he's going to get down to about the 3 yard line. Boy, change direction on a couple of occasions there, Nick, and that is one heck of a talented football player.
He's got some moves. I think there's some jockstrap sitting in the backfield there. That was... Boy, he didn't look like anything was there. And then, whoop, quick little juke back to the left there and you know, gets a positive out of very little.
Second and goal on the lip of the Clan goal line at about the 2 or 3 yard line here for Humboldt State. Gardner, this time he's going to run into a pile and not be able to push his way. The Clan are going to rally around the ball and stop Jaquan Gardner. But Simon Fraser coming up and answering the bell there. A nice play by the Clan.
Yeah, and that'll bring up third down here, Howie. Could be a big, you know, momentum swing here if they're able to stop on third down. Looks like there's a couple injured players down there on the field. Maybe a couple from both teams. There's a Clan member down on the field. And Howie, when we have a little bit of a break here, just bring up the... SFU men's soccer in action tonight against Hawaii Pacific, and as you mentioned, finishing off their non-conference swing out on out a vacation there in Hawaii. Taking on Hawaii Pacific, and currently in the 83rd minute, Simon Fraser up 2-1.
Big results for Clint Schneider's group. You're right about that, Nick. And yeah, you know what? The islands are beautiful, but they have gone there with some purpose, some business in mind, and this team ranked 6th in the country is just doing a terrific job getting back to the level of that NCAA Final Four back-to-back team from a few years ago.
Yeah, and really had a big win earlier in the season against the ranked opponents, and have really kept their momentum going from there. I think that, you know, it's 2-1, and that I think that's the second goal they've conceded in, you know, 6 or 7 games now. So really focusing on defense you know, playing really well, and Clint Schneider's got his group well in order there, and look forward to having them back in the country and seeing them play up at Burnaby Mountain at Terry Fox Field later this month.
They're going to be great on Fox Field, and we'll get back to the game here as Brad Lyons, number 50, has helped off the field. He's been critical in a number of tackles. He's done a great job, but struggling a bit as he comes off the field. Number 50, the former Terry Fox Ravens player, Lyons. So the task at hand remains, can they keep the Humboldt State Broncos out of the end zone, Nick? Third and goal now for Weber and company. Zaire now in the backfield. As Weber takes the snap, fakes, fires to Doctor, and Doctor is going to score the touchdown for Humboldt State. So Doctor, the running back, has caught a pair of touchdown passes.
Yeah, and just seemed to catch the Clan off guard there. Clan kind of sold out for the run there and able to quickly swing that ball out to the left side there and catching his second touchdown pass, able to slip into the end zone for that touchdown, making it 41-3 at this point, just over 9 minutes left in the third quarter. Yeah, nice play. We'll see the replay here. Just slings it out, and more blockers than tacklers. Waltzes into the end zone for his second touchdown of the game.
So the extra point pending on a 42-3 lead with a make here, and it will go through. So 42-3 is now the score. Gardner took a seat on the sidelines. They brought Zaire in, but it was a fake to Doctor at the goal line, and he's able to score his second receiving touchdown of the game. 42-3 is the score. So Simon Fraser now ready to hopefully try and build on some positives towards the end of that first half. They weren't able to get the ball into the end zone. Let's face it, Nick, they played 10-plus quarters and haven't scored an offensive touchdown. Do you sense one with your football karma right now?
I do, Howie. It's been a slow build towards this game here tonight. And, you know, they have struggled both in the red zone and on offense.
Yeah.
And, you know, 42-3 is obviously not where you want to be in this in the third quarter, early in the third quarter. But looking to build on those positive things that they've done. You know, Jana has had a great...
Oh, I've loved Jana's play. I think he's been, you know, one of the bright spots in this game.
And Richardson has looked more comfortable there in the pocket and on the move. So getting some quick completions, some quick stuff against Humboldt here will be key to making sure that, you know, they can put some points on the board and hopefully their first offensive touchdown of the season.
Well, Simon Fraser now back to receive. Gavin Cobb has been the primary return man, number 11 from Mount Doug. The pure freshman is back there, standing just by his goal line. And it will indeed head Cobb's way. He's going to take it off of a bow and let it bounce, actually.
And that'll be a touchback there, Howie, through the end zone and come out to the 25, which will be best starting field position they've had so far.
We'll see what the Clan can do here, yeah. As we mentioned, Ante Litre unable to play today with an injury. Wasn't able to get into full week practice as well, but Jana, number 10, has stepped in. A different kind of back. Shifty and elusive.
Yeah, a little bit more shifty. Ante is a little bit more of a downhill runner, so Jana's a good change of pace back, and he's been good out of the backfield, catching the ball as well on some swing passes, getting some positive yardages. So good to see that he's taking advantage of the opportunity that's in front of him. And, you know, his time in the spotlight has gone well so far.
Delorier and Franklin to the high side of the field. Buren to the near side of the field. They fake the handoff to Jenna. Richardson steps up, delivers the ball, and it's picked off. Oh, it's dropped right in front of Buren, number 10. That was Julian Owens, and he is... They're going to have to console him, Nick. He thought he had that pick.
Boy, they baited Richardson into throwing that ball. The low man pressed, the corner pressed and let the receiver go up the sideline, but the safety was right over the top. Looked like the cover two coverage there and was able to jump in front of that pass from Richardson. Luckily, though, for the Clan, unable to bring it down.
Well, it took a shot there. It almost paid off, but almost got picked off. They're lucky to still have the football here on second and 10 from their own 25. Buren in motion. Richardson rolling and throwing to an empty sideline on the far side of the field. It's going to bring on third down. So Simon Fraser right back to a third and long here, trying to build on what happened in the first half. They were able to come away with a field goal, but no more. And it was the first half in which they were outgained total yardage-wise, 256-86. Two receivers high, two receivers low here for Richardson. He's going to look to the far side of the field. No, now down the middle. Big pass up to Buren, and Buren with a great catch! Justin Buren! He hangs on to the football. What a play down to the Humboldt 35-yard line.
Boy, it didn't look like there was much there, Howie. I think Richardson just kind of said, well, screw it. I'm going to huck this down the field. And Buren, anytime you're throwing that ball up to Buren, he's an athletic guy, coming up and over two Humboldt defensive backs there, making a great grab on that play and getting a first down.
Boy, he got it at the apex of his jump and was falling backwards as he gained control and maintained that to the ground. So great play here for the Clan. They will hand it off now to Jana, and he finds a big hole through the middle. Jana to the 10. Oh, he's in for the touchdown.
They just marked him short at the one, Howie. Just at the one. But, boy, that was a nice burst of speed from Jana there. That left side really opened up.
Wow, great run by Jalen Jana.
He's got some speed, and I like what he does. He doesn't run out of bounds. He puts his head down, tries for that end zone. Just comes down short.
Apologies to those watching. Didn't get the touchdown call, but the Clan in great position here to score their first offensive touchdown of the season.
Yeah, nice run by Jana on that left side, and was able to get down inside the Humboldt red zone here, and we'll see what they can do.
There's a timeout on the field, I think.
Timeout, Simon Fraser here.
Well, Jalen Jana certainly on the heels of a great play by Buren. A big play, two big plays back-to-back here by Simon Fraser to put themselves in position.
He's been one of the big bright spots tonight, really showing off his speed, his shiftiness. Again, like we mentioned, Litre's out with an injury, didn't practice all week. Kind of thought, what are we getting in Jana? But he's had a great game. And kudos to that offensive line who, has really struggled these first two games, hasn't, had positive yardage on the ground. They've been able to come together, maybe not so much in that first quarter, but really getting their reads down. Again, we're seeing a replay of that beautiful Buren catch, and then the Jana run after that as well. And some big plays that we're not used to seeing from the Clan so far this year, but hopefully there's more of that to come.
You love how one play plays off of the other and creates opportunities here for the Clan. Simon Fraser looking for that touchdown. Richardson is...
It was Richardson faked the pitch there, and probably an option to either pitch it to Jana or keep it himself. Looks like might have been better off to pitch it to Jana there. Takes a loss of about 3 yards.
Yeah, it was a direct snap to Cassette, I believe.
Oh, sorry about that. They were in their little wildcat formation there. Didn't really go as planned, obviously. Now Richardson in shotgun, in the traditional shotgun with Jana on his right side there.
Buren in motion to the near side of the field. Richardson looks to his left, and he's got Buren. Oh, and couldn't hold on to the ball right at the 1 yard line. Wow.
That's a tough one. Buren runs a good route. Kind of wish he would have pushed himself a little bit further into the end zone so when he comes, if he's coming down with that ball, he's not coming down
into
at the
end zone, yeah.
He's coming down into the end zone. But a nice route. Unfortunately, couldn't come down with it for the touchdown. So third down here and possibly
third and goal. Yeah, third and goal from the 4. And Richardson will take the snap. Delorier in motion to the high side of the field. Richardson rolling right.
He's got him.
Got a man, and he's got him for the touchdown. Simon Fraser to Tom Franklin, the South Delta Sun Devil product, coming down with the touchdown for the Simon Fraser Clan. A huge moment for that Clan offense to finally get an offensive touchdown.
That's a monkey off their back for sure, Howie. A nice little flat, route into the flat there by Franklin. Richardson able to pull that ball. A little bit of a half roll, able to get him moving. It's amazing his accuracy when he's on the run and throws on the run. Gets that first touchdown pass of the season, and that must be a relief for him as well.
So here's Spink on for the extra point, and it is good. So the Simon Fraser Clan put a touchdown with a convert on the board, and it makes it 42-10 here with 6:36 remaining in the third quarter. There were big plays all over that drive, and boy, that's something to build off for the Clan.
Yeah, for sure. And what we talked about was trying to put some of this good stuff that we saw in the second quarter, put it together here in the second half, trying to, coming back from 32 down is maybe not the most likeliest scenario, but putting some good things together and focusing on those fundamentals, getting some good runs by Jana, getting some good tosses by Richardson. So, there's some good things here in this offense, and we're seeing that come to light in the second half.
So Simon Fraser now set to kick off, and perhaps that touchdown got a bit of Humboldt's attention. Of course, the lead's still very healthy here for the visitors, 42-10. Simon Fraser set to kick off from their own 35-yard line, and back to receive for the Clan Doctor, number 21, and number 6, Dylan Zuvrink. And it looks like it's going to be Zuvrink with the football. He's at the 20, finds some room, and he is showing some speed as he crosses midfield, and he's finally going to get dragged down probably at about the 38-yard line.
There is a flag, though, Howie, at about the 25. Looks like it's going to be a hold against the Jacks, and this one's coming back.
We'll take a look at the replay to see if we can find out what happened there. The flag certainly did fall right at the point where he broke through the main pack.
Yeah, they called it a block in the back there. How I didn't quite see it on the replay, but you know, a lucky break for the Clan there. Really, the Humboldt returner hit the hole hard there and was able to, you know, shoot across the 50-yard line. Again, luckily for the Clan, it'll be a block in the back, and it'll take the Jacks down inside their 20-yard line, down to about their 15, I believe, and that's where they'll start first and 10.
So a bit of a strange start for Humboldt State, having great field position throughout that first half, and starting it like inside SFU territory throughout. Zaire with the carry here. He's going to get back possibly to the line of scrimmage. Simon Fraser's defense really amping it up here against Humboldt State.
And this is where the Clan's going to have to really clamp down. You know, you just had a great drive for a touchdown. What you don't want to do is have another one of those clock-bleeding drives where the Jacks are just chipping away 7-10 yards every play and bleeding this clock down. You want to stop them right here, get that three and out, force a punt, and you know, maybe you can get the ball around midfield.
Well, Humboldt State's certainly been good at those dinks and dunks throughout here. It's Wood in that quarterback. And it's picked off by the Clan! That is picked off by Simon Fraser! And they will return it inside the 10-yard line.
That's Jordan Herdman, Justin Herdman with a great read. Justin just dropping back nicely into coverage. Wood had tons of time, but wasn't able to find that open receiver down the field. I think he was looking for number 6 there for the Jacks. Zuvrink. But Herdman able to jump in front of that, and a nice little return down inside the 10-yard line, setting them up first and goal. And that's the Clan's first interception of the season, Howie, if you can believe, in their third game. So forcing some turnovers. That's another nice thing to see here from the Clan, positive.
Yeah, the 11th quarter of Simon Fraser's season results in their first offensive touchdown, their first interception. Here they are knocking on the door, first and goal. As Richardson faces some pressure, he's just going to put it up, and it's going to get picked off. Oh, boy, that's unfortunate. Simon Fraser, they put it up, put up a prayer, and Richardson, I mean, you can say in hindsight he should have just taken the sack, but...
Yeah, that's a tough play. That's Richardson just trying to make something. Boy, that's a big rush.
Oh, boy.
Down the field by Humboldt. Had two guys, you know, 10 yards down the field chasing Richardson. You know, it's tough, and if he does take the sack, then you're, you know, first and goal or second and goal from the 30-yard line. So nice of him to try and make something happen, but
what a great opportunity, though.
Yeah, unfortunately, a turnover now inside the red zone. You never want to see those, and Humboldt's going to start this drive at the 4-yard line.
Well, Humboldt State still back deep as they were before they were picked off by Jordan Herdman. Justin Herdman, check that. So starting from there, 4, they go to Zaire, who's going to battle his way up the gain of about maybe 5 yards there. Let's see if Humboldt State plays it a bit more conservative this time. They might.
Yeah, and that wasn't necessarily a great throw by Wood there on the original interception of this. Their last drive. So trying to keep it a bit more conservative, maybe chew that clock up a bit more, hand it off to Gardner as they do here, try and get some yards.
Yeah, they hand off to Gardner, and they've got Weber back in the game, number 8, the starter. So they're playing some musical chairs at quarterback here with 4:53 left in the third quarter. We're enjoying our broadcast of GNAC football from Swangard Stadium here in Burnaby. Howard Samura, Nick Sirski with the call. Third and about 4 here for Humboldt State. We don't know if he jumped or not, but the Klan think they will have the call go their way. That call. And we're going to throw to now and do this. So, Nick, we're going to bring in some special guests here.
Yeah, we've got a special guest here from the local BC Lions.
Oh, okay.
Howie, I'll grab a microphone door. I'll be involved as well. But we're going to toss a headset over to Adam Big Hill here from the BC Lions. Come on in, Adam. Here you go.
Adam, welcome to Klan TV here. Adam Big Hill of the BC Lions. You're back in your GNAC neighborhood. How are you enjoying your night here?
GNAC, yeah. No, it's been a great night for football. Very reminiscent of, my time in the GNAC.
Your time at Central Washington, of course. You were there at a great time in their program's history. How much attention do you continue to pay to GNAC football, and especially your alma mater?
Well, you know what? I do definitely follow the GNAC, and especially Central. There's a lot of good football players in the GNAC and in Division II. Guys that get overlooked for whatever reason, and it's a great conference for football, and it's definitely undervalued.
I was talking to you last year out at Lions camp about some of the great GNAC players who have gone on to play in the CFL. Just talk a bit about that, how maybe Division II football might be misunderstood by people who don't realize it's producing great pros.
Well, yeah, for whatever reason, some guys get overlooked, whether it's height, size, weight, maybe it was grades at first. There's a bunch of great football players, and, it's just great because you see these guys who get the opportunity to go ahead and play at the next level, and they really prove everybody right. Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of great football players in the GNAC. Mike Riley is obviously
for sure.
One, there's been a ton of guys that have gone out there and done it.
And maybe, Adam, talk to a bit of our young viewers out here. Obviously, we're up in Canada with some young BC kids here. That transition from the university game at Central Washington, going into the CFL, having the success that you've had, how did you find that?
Well, you know what? It was a little bit of a transition coming from the NFL-style game to the CFL-style game. But with that being said, I picked it up relatively quick. And at the end of the day, it's still about making tackles, and it's still about scoring touchdowns and blocking and tackling. So, for me, it was a great experience. I love playing in the CFL. I love getting an opportunity to come out here and show what I can do. And at the end of the day, I love to compete. And so that's what it's all about, football, young football players to, my age. If you love to compete and play a game, you're going to have fun.
Yeah, and so maybe you mentioned having a great season this year so far with the Lions. Maybe talk a bit about the success that you've had on a bye this week, but doing some great things with the Lions here this season and looking forward to this second half of the season.
Yeah, I mean, this year's we've been quite successful. 8-3. We wish we were 11-0. We feel that we let a couple slip away from us. But at the end of the day, we play pretty solid football. We've been fairly consistent. We're not where we want to be yet. We're still working hard to improve every day. We realize that being in the playoffs and win the Grey Cup, we got to continue to improve and get better. And that's the challenge, and that's the fun part about football, is coming together as a unit and seeing what you can do at the end of the year.
Last question for me, Adam, just the connection in your community, the minor football, what it all means to be a part of that and to see some young people who look up to you. You see that their eyes probably open wide when they see you. What's that like in terms of yourself and the Lions growing, in the football community?
Well, it's incredible, because as a young kid at 7 years old, I started playing football, and I never had the opportunity to meet a professional football player or ask people how to do it, what do I do. To me, it's really awesome to be able to come back and give back and see the kids and be able to inspire them and give them words of wisdom that I wish I had when I was younger. So for me, it's the ultimate experience to come out here and give back to the kids, and it's something that I thoroughly enjoy.
Perfect.
Next up, Howie, we're actually going to bring in Travis Lule, quarterback of the BC Lions as well. Thank you, Adam, for your time. Appreciate it here. Hope you enjoy the rest of your evening here. And we'll just give us a second here to bring in Travis. Howie, maybe update us on the score.
Well, Jaquan Gardner just went in for a huge touchdown run there, 49-10, as we get set to bring on Travis Lule of the BC Lions. Well, I didn't know I was going to be interviewing you tonight, sir. This is a tremendous thrill. Just wanted to get some of your thoughts on being a part of this BC football community and what it's like for you to interact, to watch a Division II football game on a bye week, and to meet young fans who must be a great thrill for you guys.
It really is. I'm such a big believer in youth sport, and obviously when we're talking football, that's what we're talking, right up my alley. So it is fun to see these young kids, and you know, I told the kids when we were talking to them down there, I didn't get to play football until I was in high school. So the kids we're talking to were 12, 13 year olds, and I wasn't even playing yet at that stage. So they just have their whole life in front of them, and there's just so many great life lessons, so many opportunities for those young guys. And I just, you know, I wanted to impress upon them to appreciate the moment, know that it's a privilege and opportunity to play the game and to learn all those lessons. You know, and so this is a treat for me. Obviously, Kelly Bates is a friend, an ex-teammate, to sort of see a GNAC game. My wife played volleyball at Western Oregon. My dad and uncles played football at Western Oregon. So, you know, and Monmouth is, you know, 30 minutes from where I grew up. So I'm obviously familiar with the conference and whatnot. I saw Humboldt play at Western Oregon when I was a senior in high school as a recruit at Western Oregon.
Back.
Yeah,
wow.
So it's just full circle for me. So this is a pretty cool little treat.
Yeah, I just want to ask you this question. You know, this team in red, Simon Fraser, is the only non-American team in NCAA sports, and there's hundreds and hundreds of U.S. schools. I think people in Canada don't realize how great the football can be at hundreds of institutions at the D2 level, even below FCS and FBS. I mean, there's so many talented players.
Oh, there really are. You know, in Division II, I played formerly 1AA football, right? And so it's the best teams in Division II are obviously right there with that caliber of team. So, I understand, you know, the level of some of these players out here. John Jennings is a Division II football player. He's playing great football for us right now. There's a ton of talent out there. There's just not enough Division I universities to catch every single kid. So there's going to be guys that fall through the cracks and, you know, guys that maybe are just later developing. So there really is a ton of talent in Division II, and it's good football. It's fun to see.
Now, your friend Kelly Bates has taken on a huge, huge job here to change the culture of a football program, try and turn it around and recruit. And they had so many coaches, Travis, in such a short period of time. It's been hard to you feel for your friend.
I do. I mean, yeah, I you know, obviously having been through, you know, a bit of a program turnaround at Montana State myself, the program was 0-11 2 years before I went there with a new head coach. Mm-hmm. So we were part of that transition, my era of football at Montana State. So I get that. I get the whole idea of changing a culture. We hadn't been to the playoffs in 20 years. It was a huge deal for the boosters and the alums when we started to compete again at that level that you know, that everybody has such high expectations for. And so it was fun, but it's a challenging process. But Kelly is a really committed individual. I know he cares a lot about wherever he's at. Mm-hmm. He cared like crazy when he's a coach with the BC Lions, and I know he's putting everything he's got into, you know, making this program what he wants it to be. So I wish him well.
All right, Nick, you've got a question here.
You know, Travis, like you, I didn't start playing football until high school. And so maybe some advice for some of those late bloomers out there that don't start playing football, organized football, till later on in their careers, and what they can do to get to that next level, to university and to the pros.
Well, yeah, well, you know, I'm a big believer in well-rounded athletes, so kids playing all kinds of different sports when they're young. And you know, I mean, I'm a perfect example of that. I played football on the playground or, you know, on Thanksgiving weekends with my family and cousins and whatnot, but never played organized football till high school. But, I was able to step in and, you know, and compete with these guys that have been playing Pop Warner since they were younger. So that's a great throw and catch right there. You know, so for me, getting involved in anything and everything, all those moments when you're shooting free throws in a basketball game in a pressure situation, you know, that directly relates to having the ball in your hand as a quarterback in the fourth quarter of a game when you're trying to tie a game and drive. So there's just so many scenarios that really do correlate to the other sports that I just think the more you can get involved in, the more pressure situations, the wider the skill set that you can develop, I think the better off a guy is, you know, later on in life.
Yeah. And for sure, many, I totally agree with you on that one. Obviously, lots of Lions fans listening to our broadcast tonight here in the Lower Mainland. Maybe speak to the success of the team, how you guys have done it this season, and talk about what lies ahead here as you try and peak towards the end of the second half of the season.
Yeah, you said it best right there. You know, obviously, feel good about being 8-3 at this point, but we know there's a ton of football left, right? And you know, I think Kahari said it great today. He said, you know, we're 8-3, so what's that mean? We could be an 8-10 team, or we could be a 15-3 team, or somewhere in between. So it's up to us. So we know there's a lot of football ahead. I really think Wally Buono has made a big difference being back. He just has such a winning mentality. That is all the man cares about. And whether you agree with him or not on his process, you know exactly where he stands, and he demands a lot out of the guys. He's very direct, but it feels like old hat to me. This is the guy that led us to a championship. The last game that I played with Wally on the sidelines, we were hoisting that Grey Cup trophy. So obviously for me, that's great memories. It's good to have him back on the sidelines. But he's really fostered an environment where we compete like crazy every single day. The practice tempo is just considerably ramped up from what it's been over the last few years, and I think that's directly results in guys buying in and competing and playing at a high level on game day. So it's been fun to be a part of, but the best is yet to come.
Well, Travis, we want to thank you for joining us. You know, just and all of us watching the success of the BC Lions this year and what led to it with a tough season last year, clearly, I mean, you're part of the football fabric of the city, and I think everybody just appreciates the way that you are a teammate, and I've seen it firsthand, and it really is a great thing to be a part of. No better person to be here to mix with minor football and talk about some NCAA football today. So thank you so much for joining us here on Clan TV. We really appreciate it.
Absolutely appreciate the good words.
Thanks so much.
All right, you bet.
All right, that's Travis Lule, and we had Adam Big Hill as well, two big hitters from the BC Lions here, and it has all happened throughout the waning stages of the third quarter of this GNAC football game. It's a 49-10 lead for Humboldt State. While we were on the interview, Jaquan Gardner went on a big run. And I got to tell you, Nick Sirski, great questions to both of our guests here. I was so busy listening to your questions and their responses that I think the Clan actually made a couple nice forays down the field. Didn't result in any points, but you know what? In the whole context of football mattering in British Columbia, I think those two guys represent a huge part of it. Great to have them, right?
Grassroots football is what stuff is all about.
Oh, sorry. Grassroots football is, you know, what the sport's all about. And, you know, Travis mentioned, you know, not starting until high school. I was a late starter as well. I didn't start playing until grade 10. And I totally agree with him, the concept of specializing too early, you know, specializing kids, not playing multiple sports, you know, throughout their young career. And so we need to preach, you know, talking with young athletes, getting them to play multiple sports, you know, don't get too honed in on playing hockey, playing soccer, really develop those cross-sport skills that you can do, and Travis was a big proponent of that. Football can be a piece of that, obviously. You know, football is where I, you know, I made my livelihood, but I didn't make much livelihood, but but, you know, made you know, my best friends that I've had for the rest of my life, but it was really, and I really enjoyed what Travis said about keeping, you know, a multi-sport athlete for as long as you can. Because it really promotes, you know, your body to do different kinds of movements and you know, being
Oh, you know what, Nick? Sort of jump in there. Yeah. I can't believe they didn't throw a flag there.
I thought that was
looked like
pass interference.
Pass
as well,
interference, and the Clan fans are booing. You can hear that. But they were going to Franklin in the corner of the end zone. Sorry to cut you off. Important what you were saying.
But no, I really do enjoy what Travis said about you know, keeping kids active all the time, and you know, they play 60 and all these kind of things that the NFL does as well, and I think the CFL is doing a much better job of that and getting in the grassroots, getting into the community. You know, tonight here we had playing at halftime four minor youth football teams playing out on the field, you know, having a good time with their friends, coming out to the football game, and that's what sport is all about. You know, not necessarily always going to be high performance, like oh, and we got a ball in the end zone.
I think he caught that out of bounds. That was Buren.
But you know, it's not always about high performance athletics. Obviously, we do have high performance athletics here at SFU, but you know, just being involved and playing and you know, having those sort of you know, playing multiple sports and getting, you know, getting to know your friends and you know, all that kind of stuff, making those lasting memories that aren't maybe necessarily made on the field. You know, you obviously do have those on the field as well. Travis mentioned, you know, lifting that Grey Cup with Wally Buono was obviously something he's never going to forget, but I'm sure he also remembers playing catch in grade 10 for that first time in his first practice with his buddies. So great to hear, you know, some insight from those guys, real, you know, pillars in the Vancouver community and Lower Mainland BC, in the minor football associations.
Jana throwing to the end zone, looking for Franklin. There's a flag in the end zone. They're signaling a touchdown.
Boy, that was quite the play by Franklin there, Howie. We've missed some good football. We've been talking so much.
Hey, the stuff we're talking about matters in the whole context, and I know SFU head coach Kelly Bates would agree that many, many things are important to building a football team in
Look
this community.
Look at that, Howie.
But what a great catch and play that was.
We're sending that to ESPN for the play of the night. He put one hand behind the back of the other defensive back, pulls it towards his body, and controls it through the whole process, and, you know, scores a touchdown, flips it up there. Look at that.
Wow.
Athleticism by Franklin there. And that's something that we'll hope we'll see more of this season.
Well, some good signs here in the second half for Simon Fraser. We're about a minute into the fourth quarter. Howard Samura, Nick Sersky here with you. And a couple of BC Lions on. While the Clan, that extra point was deflected, but still went through. Must have had about 2 inches to clear as it went over the bar. So Simon Fraser doing their best to keep things as respectable as they can here and are really growing offensively. They're showing a lot of resourcefulness, and you gotta point to Joe Pow Pow.
Yeah, and a lot of just, you know, stick-to-itiveness, right? Just, you know, sticking with the game plan. Obviously, the first quarter did not go how they wanted to, and you know, a lot of touchdowns since then as well. But putting some positive things together. Humboldt's a very good team. Next week, playing Azusa Pacific is going to be another tough game as well. So they're going to have to build and grow, and, you know, this steps on a ladder as the season is, and you just want to keep going up. You don't want to regress. So keep this going, you know, up. And Adam talked a bit about that, is, you know, you need to peak later on in the season. It doesn't really matter where you are early on. So really looking to build a good culture and a good good confidence in this team.
Can I just say, that guy looks like a linebacker. Not that you don't look like a linebacker, my friend Nick Sersky, but Adam Big Hill.
I wouldn't want to run into him in an alley, that's
game
for sure.
Game day warrior, man. There's no question. Yeah. I covered the Lions last year. Great to be around the energy that guy brings. It's amazing.
And, you know, for those young listeners out there, he took the route of going Division II football, playing at Central Washington. So, you know, lots of different ways to do it, CIS, NCAA, Division II. You know, lots of different ways to play football, and you know what? If you're good enough, somebody's going to notice you, and they're going to give you a call, you know, you can get a scholarship, move on up, play some university athletics, and, you know, possibly make the pros like those two guys.
Great job there on specials by Jordan Leach. He gets in for the tackle. Humboldt State here, as we mentioned, 49-17. Gardner has two huge touchdown runs in this game. And Doctor, the running back, with two touchdown catches, among the highlights for Humboldt State, who are first and 10. Simon Fraser getting some penetration there up front, Nick, and they trip up the ball carrier.
I think that was the Herdman twins back in the backfield again, making a nice stop, short gain there for running back there, second and 10. But, you know, the Clan's still fighting, still trying to make some positives out of this. You know, not great scoreline, but really trying to stick to it and get some good things going.
Well, it's no quit effort here as Doctor turns a corner. Looks like a gain of about 7 for Doctor. So Humboldt stayed here, and they've shown some good resiliency on offense themselves. Other than the big plays, have still managed to consistently grind out the drives here tonight, and that's why they put 7 touchdowns on the board here, 49-17. Third and 3 right now for Humboldt State, looking to keep the chains moving here. Wood hands it off to Doctor, and he's got enough for the first down as he crosses the 40-yard line.
You know, nice to see a big game from Tom Franklin here, the freshman, 6'4", 210 from Ladner, true freshman, only had one catch coming into the game, and coming into the night, I'm sure if you would have talked to him this morning and asked him if he would have scored 2 touchdowns, it would have been a good night. So he's really coming into his own. Big target for Richardson in the red zone, but also up the field as well. So nice to see him do well.
Well, there has to be a payoff for the pain, Nick, is the way I look at it. It's a great job there. Thrown back there by the Clans, Tyrell Radich, number 41. If you're going to play your freshman and you're going to lose, they got to grow. And we're seeing it with Delorier, seeing it with Franklin. Cobb stepping in as a pure freshman this year. That's the way they've got to get it done.
Right, and you want to get those, you know, positive learning experiences. You know, obviously going to Idaho and getting your butts kicked and then going to Texas and not doing so well as well. But you want to keep building, and I keep saying that word building because I think that's what Kelly Bates is trying to do, is build a positive culture here at Simon Fraser University. You know, build, you know, good men who are good people in society, really, you know, working towards that all around, you know, being a good kid, you know, doing your schoolwork, doing your, you know, playing your games and being well in the community as well. And I think that's what he's trying to instill in this clan culture.
Justin Herdman limping off the field. We'll keep an eye on his status as the Broncos are stymied at the line of scrimmage again by the clan defensive front.
Yeah, that was Kemp in the backfield again. I know he got burned there on that touchdown pass earlier in the game, but he's really stepped up his game, making some plays in the backfield and holding his own there on that weak side linebacker.
Well, I think snap to snap, when you start to see the growth like that in Kemp, you kind of buy into the plan here that Kelly Bates has to get these guys trial by fire, and just not a lot of depth at so many positions, but the Clan are playing better as this game progresses. Here's Wood with nowhere to go. He's going to feel it, and he gets three Clan players, including Herdman, 57, who lays the big blow, loses his helmet in the process.
Boy, he got thumped there. That was great coverage down the field by the Clan. And then we're able to rally up and make that tackle. Won't go down as a sack, as he did quite got a little bit of a gain there. But first time seeing this tonight, the Humboldt State punting unit. So that's a nice relief.
And you're right, great play in that secondary. Really forces things and forces the issue for that linebacking group to get up and put some pressure on the quarterback. So Humboldt State now set to punt. And I tell you, we got to talk before this game is over about roll the rock. Kelly Bates' team mantra this year about the ability to persevere. And that ball is going to be fielded at the 1 yard line. Humboldt State doing a great job there.
Yeah, that'll flip the field position.
It will. But hey, this roll the rock thing, and I asked him what roll the rock means, and it's based on the myth of Sisyphus, of the guy who would roll the rock up the hill the whole day, and at the end of the day it would just come rolling back down, condemned to do that for eternity, but learning about yourself in the whole process. I think it's the perfect way to describe what a young team that will hit growing pains might go through, and credit to coach for really getting that, you know, as part of the buy-in for this season.
And you had a ton of seniors graduate last year. And, you know, didn't have a very successful season going 0-9. Coming into the season again, yeah, looking to put those building blocks in place with some young guys and really getting some, you know, Kelly Bates and the recruiting staff did a great job of recruiting some really good skill position players. We're seeing it in Franklin. We're seeing it in Cobb. And so, you know, these guys are, you know, coming into their own here.
Oh! And Buren makes a great.
Just slipped out.
Whoa. Just slipped out of his hands. That came from Richardson out of the end zone, 30 yards downfield, and Buren unable to pull that one in.
And we're seeing the young kids making an impact. Jana in the backfield as well. So you're really, those are going to be your pillars moving forward. Obviously, you have your seniors, your Gakusana, your Herdman twins that are, you know, going to continue to support you, hopefully after they graduate this season. But it's going to be these young skill positions that are coming in. Kelly Bates' first and second recruiting classes here that are going to be making the impact in years to come.
Ooh, swatted away there, Nick, as we jump back to live action. So that's going to bring third down for the Clan.
You know, we talk about the young guys too, right? Richardson's only a redshirt sophomore, so, you know, he's got three more years to go in this offense. And, you know, looking poised at moments, a little bit jittery at others, but I think that's what you're going to get with a young quarterback. And, you know, hopefully as he moves through this offense, gets more comfortable with Joe Pau-Pau's offense and these young receivers that they have, this good mix of veterans and young guys, you know, making it better out there.
Third down here from the end zone. Richardson's going to air it out, and it is going to go unclaimed by Buren, who is unable to catch up with it.
A late flag there in the end zone, Howie. I'm not sure what that was. Maybe some chatter after the...
And we've had enough of that tonight, Nick.
Let's see.
It looks like the Clan players are very curious as to how the call is going to go.
I must have been a Clan member because Humboldt was all walking away. I didn't see much on their end.
Yeah, Number 55 of the clan seem most concerned there. Gakasana getting called for the penalty.
And that's probably just some frustration at this point boiling over. It has been a tough game, and you know, you can understand you know, what they're going through. Nobody likes being down, you know, 49-17 in the fourth quarter. But you know, Gakusana is a senior. He's got to lead by example. You really hope not to see those kind of things from your senior guys. But you can understand when it does happen. You know, frustration is.
That is a tough kick. But what great field position as Zuvrink tries to weave his way. He changes direction, cuts up the middle, fumbles the football, and the Clan have fallen on it. Simon Fraser football.
Boy, Howie, that's. At least some of the bounces are going your way, right? You know, last week in, or 2 weeks ago in Idaho, they actually took a safety in their end zone when they were backed up like that, which is a very CFL Canadian football type thing.
I was listening to that too, yeah. And they could not figure out why. You know what?
The commentators were amazed.
They were amazed.
If anybody at Humboldt is you know, listening to us and watching the video, that is a very Canadian football type thing to do, is take that safety in your end zone. So seeing that. Seeing him kick it, I was actually a bit surprised. I thought he was going to take a knee. And then, obviously, the great field position for Humboldt, but then the fumble. And, unfortunately, you know, for Humboldt, the Clan get the ball back into their hands.
Jana, though, is swarm, Nick, as he takes that handoff. Bit of a reprieve here for the Clan. They, with 10:14 remaining, get the football back.
I mean, it's nice to get a break every once in a while. So that's... That's good luck, good fortune for the Clan, and hopefully they can do something with this gift of a possession.
Zuvrink took that low kick and really looked to be off to the races, but whoop, the ball just flipped out of his hand.
And I shouldn't say gift. Clan, wasn't able to catch it on the replay, but a member of the Clan was able to strip that ball quite nicely, and that's what they teach you. It was one of the Herdman twins that actually made the play. So,
Chana, though, dancing this time. Great job. He's got a quick burst, and his ability to run through traffic really has grown as this game has gone along.
He's not afraid either. He's putting his head down, getting into traffic, you know, not peeking over his shoulder, worried about any of those big boys coming to hit him. So good on him. Gets a first down on that great run, and he's continuing to have a spectacular day.
Well, you know what? There's no easy ones in the GNAC, but if you start to develop a 1-2 punch to the ability of Jana and a healthy Ante Leacher, Nick, you got to think that gives him more options. It's going to open everything else up.
It's like a lightning and thunder you know, duo in the backfield, Howie, and so it's really good to see your backup running back get some good.
A tough catch over the middle. Gavin Cobb, the pure freshman, knew he was going to feel the thunder, Nick, and he holds on. That was all catch, and he knew he was going to get killed after the play.
Nice strong hands from the freshman, right? You're going up in traffic, making that catch. We'll see a replay here. And Richardson with it puts that, you know, only Cobb's going to catch that with those strong hands. A nice hit by the safety there as well, but Cobb able to hold on and make a good play.
Yeah, Castro, number 20, lays the lumber down, but Cobb holds on to it. And Jana now straight arming, trying to gain some traction, but can't do it. He's going to lose a bunch of yards here, maybe 5 yards loss on that play. But that's the thing about Cobb. We watched the Idaho State game. Cobb was making catches on the team's first drive of the game. Tough catches over the middle. The kid's fearless over the middle, and you got to love that quality so early in his career.
Exactly, and from a freshman, you don't normally expect to see that. They kind of, you know, dip your toe in the water and then slowly wade in. But, you know, he's going in there 110% and really, working towards becoming a real pivotal part of this offense.
Second and 15 now for Richardson. 5-yard loss on the last play out of the gun. He fires to Cobb in the open field. Cobb makes you miss. He's on the sidelines, and he'll be pushed out of bounds. At about midfield, Gavin Cobb doesn't look like a pure freshman on the field right now.
No, absolutely, and a nice little shimmy shake there on that quick pass, and really showing off some fancy footwork and some speed to get when the second and long, able to get that first down. Again, we'll see a replay here. Just a quick little out pattern and a woo, see you later, number one. Down the sideline makes that nice play.
Yeah, BC High School football's AAA player of the year, Gavin Cobb. Great move there. This time, Jana with the handoff runs into his own man. is going to get the first down, and Jenna keeps going. He's got the football, and he's headed for the end zone. It's Jenna, touchdown, Simon Fraser-Klein.
Boy, it sure is nice, Howie, to not see these kids give up. And, you know, they could have, you know, easily rolled over and just given up on this game. But Janice still out there. The offensive line still out there blocking hard. A nice run to the left side and able to cut it back towards the middle of the field. Even the receivers blocking downfield. We had a receiver down at the goal line pushing their blocker into the end zone. So great work by Jana getting down the field. And a kudos to the whole offense to keep putting some good drives together.
Well, they add the extra point, and they make it 49-24. Jalen Jana, one of the bright spots coming out of this game. We've talked about him throughout, and boy, he's got a nice explosive burst. And we'll take a look at that score here on Clan TV.
Well, he makes a couple tacklers miss at Jana, and look at this speed down the field. That's 11 blocking downfield as well. Is that Franklin too down the field? No, that's 15 as well.
Buren with a nice job there.
Buren with it, blocking 40 yards downfield. That's what you want to see. You know what? You know, you're down 25 points in the fourth quarter, but these guys are still trying hard, and I think that's what Coach Bates is really trying to instill, that work ethic in this team. You know, not give up, keep working hard, keep blocking downfield, you know, sustaining those blocks, and that's just a great play, and you, there you see the benefits.
Well, you know what? If you care about football in this province and care about the programs being healthy and really to see what happened last week at A&M, and I was texting you know, our executive producer, Gabe Lennon, saying, well, this is 40-0. This is not a healthy thing. It's scary in a lot of ways to think the damage something like that can cause, but to see them come back from a game where they were held to negative rushing yardage, I mean, they're not going to win the football game, but I think they won on a whole lot of levels tonight.
Exactly, especially, you know, that first quarter didn't go very well, obviously, 28-0, you know, 2 seconds into the second quarter. But, again, showing that guts, showing that work ethic that I think Bates, Coach Kelly Bates, wants to instill. You know, you don't want to see being down 40-0 or 28-0 very often. But, yeah, you know, this week they're trying hard. They're putting together some offense. And even defensively, you know, really working hard to stop this Humboldt team as they get a nice return here.
Yeah, they're getting out to midfield again. But hey, the Clan are used to that tonight.
But hey, you know, they're still playing hard out there. As you mentioned, their depth is always being tested. They have a pretty small roster compared to many teams out there. So really, just trying to continue that work ethic, build that strength, build that rapport with their teammates, and working on that.
You want to talk about the size of a roster? Line that up, Nick Sirski, and count how many extra names you see on that Humboldt State roster. I mean, it's a huge thing.
Exactly, and you're watching them in practice, and you know they're playing. You know, traditionally you have an offensive defensive portion of your game. Well, they don't have enough offensive linemen to have two full sets of offensive linemen to run your first team and then have a scout team run against your defense. So that is something that they're going to need to build, and recruiting in guys and working on building that roster size and bringing in quality recruits as well. So, you know, they just don't have that depth, you know, quite just yet. But
yeah, I mean, look at their defense. Jordan Leach is listed as the number two guy on the two deep at the weak end, middle linebackers behind the Erdmans. And up front, you got Jordan Moore at both of those guard spots as the second guy on the two deep. So their depth is a question. Humboldt State fighting hard for yards right now. The Clan showing a lot of focus here.
Bringing up a big third down here, Howie, and it'd be nice if Clan could get another stop here and, you know, get the ball back with 6 minutes left. Again, the clock just ticking down to just over 6 minutes left here in the fourth quarter. Get another drive going and see what they can do.
Clan bearing down here as Humboldt State. They're going to bring the blitz, and here it comes. Great job to get rid of the ball, but they can't squeeze it. That was number seven, James Holland the third, right in the numbers, couldn't hold on to it.
And a nice play by Benedito there to rip that ball out of the hands of that receiver and bring up a nice fourth down.
Benedito stepping up and offering something defensively here for the Clan. So forcing the Humboldt State to punt. And an opportunity here for Cobb as they send a booming kick to Cobb. He's going to field it, and call for the fair catch at about the 14-yard line. 5:46 remaining. Certainly want to thank everybody on the Clan TV network here today for their help in getting this production on the air, starting with our producer engineer Gabe Lynn and a cast of thousands, Nick. I mean, there are a lot of people working here in terms of getting this production on the air today, and great to get all of the help, especially as well from the minor officials, everybody working the football game here today. Simon Fraser. First and 10 from their 15-yard line. And off to Jana. Works behind the push of his line and is going to gain a couple of yards. Boy, every time I hear the Jana surname, I've probably told you this story, but I started off as a reporter in about 1983. In 1986, I was working at the Surrey Now newspaper, it was called. And Jalen Jana's dad was a guy named Corey Jana, who was the point guard for the Queen Elizabeth Royals secondary school basketball. He was a great basketball player, and I reported on him as a 12th grader.
What a small
Here's
world,
his
eh?
son. That just shows you I've been around a little too long.
Young at heart, though, Howie. I won't tell you what year I'm born. It's okay. But really good to see him spark this offense. You know, this Jana kid's really taking this starting role. And again, had 2 weeks of negative rushing yards, and obviously not going to have that, having positive yards today, and Jana going over 100 yards for, I assume, the first time in his career. So good to see him out there. And again, this Clan offensive line really getting together and molding or,
those who thought that, they weren't going to be able to gain some traction here and get some positive results, I think they have done that here tonight.
Flags on the far side there, honey.
Interesting to ask Travis Lule. I said to him, he played, I guess, 1AA, as it was called at the time when he was playing. But I said to him, this is the only Canadian team in all of the NCAA, every single division. Like, do people here realize how many good football teams there are in the U.S. below the ones you're hearing about every week, in the AP Top 25? And he just looked at me and went, yeah, there's so many teams. And we're seeing a good one here in Humboldt State tonight.
I think in Division II, there's 250 football teams or something like that. A big number. Obviously, more that don't have football as well. I think Div 2 is upwards of a couple hundred schools in sports in general. So a lot of good competitiveness out there. And, to be that Canadian ambassador in the States. And a lot of teams take that, personally. And a lot of when they go to the States, maybe teams chirp them about mockingly, go back to Canada A or stuff like that. But a lot of the students take pride in representing their country, and the SFU logo has the maple leaf. So wearing that maple leaf on their sleeve, on their chest, on their helmet, wherever it may be, is a source of pride for these guys.
Tough pass there. I believe that was intended for Franklin. Horizon John on the field as well, number 19, the big man out of Vancouver College. Watch that kid play basketball. I mean, never seen a kid dunk so effortlessly. It was ridiculous. Rising John, what a spectacular two-sport career at Vancouver College for him.
Coach Steve Hansen knows where to go if he needs another basketball player. Eh?
I asked Ryzen when I wrote a story about him in the newspaper last year if he wanted to do that, and he said he was open to it. So I'm telling you, Coach Hansen, go to the big man. Get him in your lineup. Punt is away, and was that Zuvrink on the far side of the field?
Yep, number 6, Zuvrink.
Ball ricochets off him out of bounds. Boy, this Clan defense, you talk about what the perception of you must be after a loss at A&M Kingsville, and then to come in here and to be down by that score early. What these guys are actually made of is really something to talk about here tonight.
And I mean, after that first quarter, 21 points in three quarters is not terrible in this high-scoring GNAC conference that we have. So really good to see them clamp down, show some good effort here in the last three quarters. hopefully this is something they can build on, and those Herdman twins, you know, being the guts of that defense, making some more plays as the season progresses.
Well, I think a key thing to talk about, and it's really interesting that we can even talk about this, Nick, when you're down by 25 points with 4 minutes left in the game, but as we looked at last year's eight-game schedule and five times that they led or, you know, were tied in the third or fourth quarter, they waned as the game went on and they lost. But I think anyone who watches this game knows they're playing better now than they were playing in the first quarter. I think that's a positive sign as well to look moving forward if you're not playing a nationally top 25 team.
Right, totally. It's an interesting dynamic. Obviously, you'd like to be leading in the fourth quarter, but we are playing a very good team in Humboldt State. I think there's a flag there for against Simon Fraser, a personal foul. But yeah, so really, it was building towards the end of the season and, you know, getting Richardson, getting his feet set and, mm-hmm. and throwing some good passes and getting that confidence with this whole young group is going to be important moving forward and in the years to come.
Well, Humboldt is getting the ball at the 30-yard line. Number 36, Shaw with the carry there from Dubai.
And it's not like they're doing, you know, this isn't easy yards that Humboldt is picking up either, you know. SFU's still down there smashing and banging and wearing their heart on their sleeve. So it's good to see that effort level still up out there for the Clan. And Kelly Bates, talked about that in their past two losses as well. Just that effort level being high and, keep working and developing on things as the game goes along.
Nice run there by Shaw, though, and he's going to get stopped by Herdman. Do we see another flag on the field down there? Or was I imagining things? I think I was. So Humboldt State showing their depth at the running back spot. Shaw, as we mentioned, must have an interesting story behind him. Out of Dubai. Third and about 2.5 yards here. Fake it. And the Clan will put flag. In the kibosh there. Won't
flag
the
on the
down.
Far side as well, Howie. We'll see what that is. That's the opposite field judge down towards the goal line. So we'll see how it's a far ways away for that penalty.
Jordan Pugh making the stop there for the Clan coming out of the secondary.
At the moment, it should be fourth and short, but we'll see. Coach Bates doesn't look that happy, so it looks like it could be going against the Clan.
We'll wait the officials' call here as the Clan down to
personal foul. Defense number 4. Half the distance.
Wow. First down. So as we look at what's happened here, you know what? There's been some positives, but there's been way too many personal fouls, Nick. I mean, you just don't want to have that.
Yeah, and that's Jake Oram there, one of our defensive backs, trying to plead with his coach and saying, you know, it wasn't me, but you can't put yourself in those situations where those things are going to happen. I think, you know, by my count, that was one personal foul, but then also two taunting penalties against the Clan, and that's 45 free yards that you're never going to get back.
Teeing it up for Humboldt here, and they will look for the score. They will go to number 16. He's down about the 1 yard line, it looks like. Cassius Pierce, I believe, the wide receiver, was the guy being targeted there, and he battles at the corner.
Yep, just a quick little hook route and way to tackle there by number 16.
Jaron Bailey,
the redshirt sophomore out of Burnaby. First and goal at the 1.
And they will score the touchdown. Joe Sue, the third string quarterback, goes in for the score there, Nick, and Humboldt State 55-24 now the score.
Just under 2 minutes left, buck 54 on the clock up there with this point after attempt pending.
So Simon Fraser with their own share of defensive and offensive highlights in the second half. They're going to give up a late one here to Humboldt. Simon Fraser, though, putting 3 touchdowns on the board. 2 by Franklin and 1 by Jenna as the extra point goes through, 56-24. We're going to take a short break here if we can from Swangard Stadium. Be back with more right after this on Clan TV.
Champions keep working until they get it right. The more you dream, the harder you work, the farther you get. I'm Amadi Kamara, and I am ready for the new season.
Great leaders know their strengths and can call on the right strength at the right time. It's about setting an example to influence others so they can be better. I am Devin May, and I am ready for the new season.
And back at Swangard Stadium, the final minutes of play here. In the GNAC opener for the Simon Fraser Clan, hope you've enjoyed the broadcast on the Clan TV. Howard Samura, Nick Sirski, as the Humboldt State Lumberjacks set to kick off. We will let you know on September the 24th, the Clan will be back in action. And a 6 o'clock game is going to be at Azusa Pacific. You'll be able to watch that through the GNAC website. And October the 1st, 6 p.m. versus Central Washington Wildcats, the homecoming game, Nick, at Terry Fox Field, the first game on the hill since 2013. That's going to be a fun night.
That's going to be a lot of fun, a homecoming atmosphere there. I'm sure there'll be lots of festivities and pregame and postgame stuff to do up on the hill. So, it'll be lots of fun. If you're listening, come on up to the hill. If you're in the stands, make sure you don't come to Swangard. Go to Terry Fox Field. I'll be sure to do that as well. Looking forward to a fun homecoming event. And I know they have a lot of, like I mentioned, festivities planned for before the game. So should be a lot of fun.
Richardson's pass to the sidelines will go incomplete. It's going to be a neat atmosphere trucking those stands up there. It's not exactly an easy proposition. You've got to get the big, heavy trucks to get all that gear up there. So they're bringing the atmosphere there. I'm hopeful, and I'm hearing good things, that potentially that stadium project could be back on gear. And if that happens, I think, you know, it's going to be terrific on campus for this team.
Yeah, and I think building that culture on campus is an important thing that SFU is working on, actively working on. But the stadium project would only help. So hopefully, here goes Jana again.
Jana! Sidelines, Jana ridden out of bounds at midfield, but Jalen Jana, what a day this kid has had.
So I think it's a great idea bringing homecoming back up to the hill at Burnaby Mountain, really trying to engage the students up there and, doing some stuff before the game and during the game. I'm sure they'll honor another team at halftime as well. I don't have who it is in front of me, but I know they'll be doing that as well. Having some Burnaby Minor football teams up there as well, it'll be a great day for both young and old, and a great opportunity to enjoy a Clan football game against one of their biggest rivals in Central Washington.
Yeah, it's going to be a interesting GNAC season to see this young Clan team grow. You can look at the margin and say, you know, a lopsided loss, but a lot of questions answered. And Franklin almost makes a huge catch right through the hands of Franklin, Nick.
Oh, he made that ridiculous one-hander earlier, but couldn't catch the one that's right in his breadbasket. Unfortunately, sometimes that's how it goes, Howie. But a nice throw by Richardson as well. Again, we've seen him throw on the run, and that's something that he can do. Here we see a replay rolling out to his left. Oh, right through his hands. A big hit there laid by the safety, but Franklin knows. He should have had that one.
Boy, I'll tell you, the youth on this team, youth will be served, they say. Low snap, picked up and handed to Jana as he dances through the line and gets a gain of about 4.5, maybe 5 yards, right to the midfield stripe. Jalen Jana. And I can tell you, as Coach Bates and Pow Pow go into their meetings this week, I mean, it's got to be with a little bit more comfort, a bit more fresh air coming through the window, that they've actually seen this happening here tonight with Jana.
And I think some confidence just in that offensive line. I think they thought, you know, it was pretty shaky the past two games with the negative rushing totals. But some confidence in this running game, some confidence in Richardson's arm. You know, his completion percentage is a little bit better today. He's thrown a couple touchdown passes. So really good to see this offense progress.
Buren toeing the line there, and looks like he might have a first down on the far side of the field. Interesting as well, Nick, because you know what? They say there's no easy ones in the GNAC. Next week, you got to travel and play the team that beat this Humboldt State team the week before in Azusa Pacific. I mean, that is a real trial by fire and a way to learn, right?
It is not. Yeah, it has not been an easy first four games. The Clan, for sure. You know, and then Central Washington's no breath of fresh air either, right? They're going to come up here, and they're always a real strong team that plays us really well. So trial by fire here for this young group. But like I said, really made some strides here later on in this, you know, basically after that ugly first quarter, yeah. Really made some strides on offense and started to do some good things.
Well, you know what? Two low snaps, and it doesn't seem to hurt Jana. They're able to get those. They're going to start designing those pretty soon. Jana just scoops it up off the turf and just rolls forward. Makes it about second and 2.5 here from the 36-yard line for Simon Fraser. Richardson back in the gun. One receiver or two receivers to the near side of the field. It's a pitch. It's a fake as he rolls to his right and looks down the field. Richardson has a man, and it's picked off by the Humboldt State squad as they start running back across the 30, and they are still going here before the Simon Fraser Clan finally able to slow Davian Johnson, one of the defensive guys in the secondary, who's actually a starter still on the field here as the game is over.
And that's going to wrap up. That's the last play of the game, Howie. Final score here tonight, Humboldt State 56, SFU Clan 24. Maybe a tough night to identify a player of the game, but I think if we did have one, it'd be Jalen Jana for sure. Kid really showed some moxie there under some tough circumstances, an offensive line that had struggled earlier in the season. So Jalen Jana, to you and the offensive line, a great job tonight.
I think really a great job by Jalen Jana. And you know what? As we say, get ready for Azusa Pacific. They're going to be tough, but I think this Clan team had some questions answered today, and they've got enough that they can move forward knowing they're moving in the right direction. So I think a solid effort overall. On behalf of our executive producer, Gabriel Lynn, supervising producer, Steve Frost, and our entire crew here in Swangard Stadium, thanks for joining us tonight. We'll see you down the road as the Simon Fraser Clan continue their 2016 GNAC football season.